young players.
To be number one, something special.
Something that you'll never forget, and no one can ever take it away from you.
I probably had to go up to the bathroom, you know, 5 or 6 times in an hour because I was so nervous. Whoa, oh,
staring at this empty room. The first pick overall,
this historic pick.
We proudly select.
Looked at 1,000 different pictures that your mother took of you. You see, I had this crazy dream last night. This man, he talked to me.
Number one is a big deal. Welcome to the NHL.
Appreciate it. This is a very special day for myself, my family. Definitely something I'll remember the rest of my life.
And he said that you are the future. And the future.
It's a pretty big honor.
It was such an awesome time.
You take a lot of pride in that.
I was ecstatic.
Probably as good a day as I've ever had.
Mario
Connor McDavid.
Patrick Kane.
Steven Stamkos.
Sidney Crosby.
Eric Lindros.
Pride of being picked number one overall.
How am I supposed to answer that?
Something that was told to me a lot is the joy. It really does go by quick.
You are the future.
Looking back, number one is a big deal, but truly, it's one of 217 dreams that will come true this weekend. Today may be about where you go, built on a yesterday that seemed to make you want to work even harder. But tomorrow, it's about what you do with this opportunity. Just ask Patrick Hornquist about getting that one chance.
Let's go back 15 years ago, Sollentuna, Sweden. Your father wakes you up in the middle of the night to tell you that you've been drafted with the last overall pick. And now you are a 2-time Stanley Cup champion. What's the journey been like?
No, obviously, I mean, when you get that call that when my father wake me up there and get drafted, that's one step closer to make it to the NHL, and that was always my dream to win the cup.
Big day, let's go! Almost there! 10 seconds through! Now we're in mid through! Give me some power! Keep pushing the go! Keep pushing halfway through now! Kill this fight! Give me medals up! Give me more!
Players so thankful for what's gone into this. Nico Hischier maybe an added little thanks because he doesn't have that Jordan Marwan, the AKA the bike guy, who was an internet sensation on our Facebook live broadcast at the draft combine, in their ears, motivating the players during that exhausting test. Nico Hischier walking in tonight with Noel and Patrick. They are the top two prospects going into this draft. Still don't know really whether or not it's going to be Patrick, who's been number one throughout, but Hischier's caught him. Darren Millard here. Welcome to the first round of the NHL draft on Sportsnet, presented by Adidas, along with Sam Cosentino from CHL and Sportsnet, and drafted in 1989 by the New York Rangers, Louis DeBrusque. We've got a lot going on here, and what Patrick and Hischier were talking about was, can you believe what the Chicago Blackhawks have done? They have our interest.
They have the whole league's interest, and that's players that are already in the league, trying to make the league, and the prospects here, they're talking and buzzing, and even my son was texting me this morning, couldn't believe how things started off with the trades that happened.
Well, how about the New York Rangers? They haven't picked in the first round since going back to 2012. Brady Shea at 28. They now have 2 first-round picks, 7 and 21. How about Antti Raanta moving in the deal? There is possibility there that Jake Oettinger becomes their target with the 21st overall pick. They haven't picked inside the top 10 since Al Montoya went 6th in 2004.
Show you the details of the 3 big trades that have occurred leading into this draft, and we'll start with the Blackhawks reacquiring Brandon Saad. They get the goaltender to fill the void of Scott Darling. Artemi Panarin, plays in the same line as Patrick Kane, who we hope will join us. He goes the other way. Connor Murphy comes from the Arizona Coyotes for 3-time Stanley Cup champion Nick Chalmerson. And the 7th overall pick. Rarely top 10 picks are moved at the NHL draft in the first round, but that one goes to the New York Rangers. And just turned 28 years old into his second draft, the general manager of the Arizona Coyotes. He's had a busy last 36 hours. Dave Tippett, his head coach, parting ways with the organization yesterday. Chayka meeting the media as we send in Elliot Friedman to the draft floor. Elliot.
Well, standing here in the media zone, Darren, there's no question that we've all been working hard today because of the messages and the trades that you talked about earlier on. However, since we've been here, the focus has been on the general manager of the New York Islanders, Gar Snow. Snow had a lengthy conversation with Toronto GM Lou Lamoriello, and we believe that's about Travis Hamonic. The Islanders are definitely in active talks to move the defenseman, and Toronto was one of the teams believed to be interested. After the conversation, Garth went back, he held a conversation with Doug Waite, his coach, his cap guy, assistant GM Kerry Guider, and Chris Lamoriello, the son of Lou, who works for the Islanders. And a couple minutes ago, Snow and Lamoriello talked again. Calgary is believed to be interested in this. Tampa Bay is believed to be interested in this. But there's no question Toronto is as deep as anyone. Darren?
Thank you, Elliot. And Doug Waite, you bring up the head coach of the New York Islanders. He's also the assistant general manager to Garth Snow. The New Jersey Devils won the draft lottery. It seems like a long time ago. Now, they moved up. Do we know that they'll keep that pick yet?
Well, it's really interesting. It's kind of like found money for them when you look at where the New Jersey Devils ended up. And the thing that we've heard repeatedly since we've been here is they want to take Cale Makar, but they're not so sure that they should take him with that number one pick. What does that mean? Well, I don't think you can slide back any further than third. But if they don't end up doing that, Nico Hischier and his journey is the way in which I think they're going to go. Where's number 13 for his brother Luca, but also for this guy, Pavel Datsyuk. Datsyukian-like goal in the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League. What so impressed me about this guy was his performance at the World Juniors and his performance thereafter. Most players get a rest, they go back home, they decompress a little bit. Not this guy. He went right back in, had 20 points in the next 16 games coming back from the World Juniors. Had a bit of a dip at the end of the regular season in March. Rocketed back up with his play into the playoffs and gave the Rouyn-Noranda Huskies all they could handle, taking that higher-rated team to six games before eventually losing out.
And on the flip side, it's Nolan Patrick, who's been the consensus number one up until the last few months here, where Nico Hischier has really started to take a name for himself. And I look to the prospects game, and when they went at it, it was the viciousness that Nolan Patrick played with. And you heard Hischier talk about it, the fact that he was hard to play in the corners, on the faceoff. He was big and he was physical. And this is the turnover here that Nolan Patrick talked about. It led to the goal by Hischier. And watch after this how they have a little conversation after this puck goes in, and there was a ratchet up in the intensity of Nolan Patrick. And that's what I love about this kid's game. This guy is the most NHL-ready player, I believe, in the draft. He'll play next year in the NHL regardless of where he goes.
But you really get the sense that if New Jersey does hold on to that pick, like you said, Sam, that they're going to go in the direction of the Switzerland player. Tonight's about making an entrance, but so much of it also revolves around the journey, and that certainly rings true with Jeff Mayer, who's on the draft floor. Jeff.
Darren, thanks very much. Out here on the draft floor, it is exciting. It is also shiny. It is also very polished. 31 tables for 31 NHL teams here at the NHL draft. This is wonderful. It's quite a sight. This is the polished piece that is the NHL draft. But let's go backstage right now and introduce you to something that's never been done at the NHL draft before. You may have seen this in other sports, but never before have we seen this in the National Hockey League. As we take you backstage, you may have seen this entry shot before on Hockey Night in Canada. I should probably have a coffee mug in my hand right now as I walk through where the players would normally walk to get to their backstage area. That's where we're taking you right now, to meet players like Owen Tippett, to meet players like Gabriel Vilardi, to meet players like Klim Kostin, and to meet players that all the buzz has been about. We've heard so much about Nico Hischier. We've heard so much about Nolan Patrick. Let's meet these two young men right now. All of the buzz seems to be about who will go number one. Will it be Nico or will it be Nolan? First of all, gentlemen, I know Tyler and Taylor were sick of it by the end, Sagan and Hall, about hearing about Tyler and Taylor. How sick are you guys about hearing about Nico and Nolan? We'll start with you.
I'm not too sick of it. It's, you know, it's been real fun. I got a chance to hang out with them, so how could I be sick of it doing that? So it's been a fun experience, and you know, I've enjoyed it all, so it's been good.
Nico, same, or are you done with this? Is this going to be a relief for you?
No, kind of same. For sure you hear it a lot, but I would be happy for him. He would be happy for me, I think. So, it's kind of same.
Okay, so, Nico, you play with the Halifax Mooseheads, Quebec Major Junior Hockey League. You play with the Brandon Wheat Kings, Nolan, of the Western Hockey League. But you did meet once the top prospects game. What did you learn about Nico in that game?
I learned don't turn the puck over. He'll go back on a breakaway and score him seconds later. So I think that was instant karma for me there. But, yeah, he's obviously, you know, a real good player. And he's tough to defend against. He can skate down low and make plays, so he's obviously ranked where he is for a reason.
Nico, what'd you learn about Nolan?
For sure, I probably lost every faceoff against him. He's pretty strong in the faceoffs, and pretty strong in the corner too. I can remember he crashed me sometimes on the board, so, and yeah, for sure, great player, and it was fun. for sure.
You're both great players, no matter what happens this evening. The end of one journey and the beginning of another one this evening. For Nolan Patrick and Nico Hischier, Darren, back to you.
Thank you. Canadian content in this draft is back loaded. The exception is Vancouver, who for the second straight year pick fifth overall. General managers with Elliot.
Jim, you've done this throughout your career about a million times. I wonder, do you ever look at a draft like this and say, I'm picking five and I know what's going to happen in front of me?
Well, I think this is the type of year where, you know, there's the top two guys at the top and then it's unpredictable after that. So, you know, at five, we're excited. We think we're going to end up with a real good player. But I just don't know the order of after the top two guys.
Have you had much interest in anyone coming for you for your pick?
We've had a lot of talks. It was, you know, to move up, it was just going to be too tough. We were going to have to give up, you know, too big of an asset to get up. We talked about going back, so we'll see what happens when our pick's there.
And finally, do you look at this and say, we're going for need as opposed to best player available? No,
we're going to take the best player. You know, it would be nice if he's a playmaking center iceman or power play defenseman, but we're going to take the best player where we pick.
Thanks very much, Jim. Good luck.
Thanks, Elliot.
Darren?
Reaping the benefits of the draft from 2 years ago, Brock Besser scored his NHL debut for the Vancouver Canucks. Fifth overall, and then it's Calgary at 16. The psychology of the draft as we continue here in Chicago.
Hockey Central Draft Preview Show brought to you by Golf Town, your destination for everything golf in Canada. Put away the sticks and dust off your clubs because now we golf.
All-new Discovery. Land Rover, above and beyond.
With 100% whole wheat for your grown-up side and a touch of sweet for the kid in you, Kellogg's Mini Wheats takes your grown-up day and adds a little play. Feed your inner kid with Kellogg's Mini Wheats.
Old MacDonald had a farm, E-I-E-I-O, and on his farm he had some chicks. E-I-E-I-O, with a tick-tick here and a tick-tick there, here a tick, there a tick, everywhere a tick-tick, old MacDonald.
If old MacDonald had a farm today, he'd have a Coyote tractor on it for sure. E-I-E-I-O. Test drive one at your local Coyote dealer. E-I-E-I-O.
Every bottle of Sleeman has a story, and our Railside Session Ale is no exception. Back in the 1800s, on the way to our brewery, hops would fall by the railside. Those hops are still growing wild there today. They're the inspiration for our Railside Session Ale, a distinctly flavorful beer with a crisp finish. We hope you'll enjoy it as much as we did making it. Sleeman Railside Session Ale. It's notoriously good.
Sportsnet Now. Live stream sports. Visit snnow.ca for details.
The NHL draft.
Sportsnet proud to announce that Cornerbrook, Newfoundland and Labrador has been named the host for Scotiabank Hockey Day in Canada for 2018. Nestled in the scenic Humber Valley of Newfoundland's west coast, Cornerbrook is home to Cornerbrook Royals Minor Hockey Association, where hockey is at the center of the social and recreation activity. Ron McLean, once again, will host a marathon celebration of the game on January 20th. Join us as we present the 18th edition of Scotiabank Hockey Day in Canada. Also look back to 2004 at some point during this draft, because of Shaughnevin, there's a great connection to a player that's available tonight. So New Jersey has that first overall pick. Ray Shiro back in control of the New Jersey Devils after that long run in Pittsburgh, and one of the people he brought with him from the Penguins, Amy Kimball, sports psychologist, and she played a major part in who the Devils will pick tonight. Tara Sloan.
Thank you very much, Darren. Yes, Dr. Amy Kimball is a sports psychologist, and she was actually with the Pittsburgh Penguins for 10 years, part of two Stanley Cup championship winning teams. Ray Shiro scooped you up and grabbed you, and you had a big part to play during the scouting combine with the interview process. What exactly is your job there?
My job there is to interview the players and find out what they're really like, what makes them tick, how competitive they are. We know they're good hockey players. We want to make sure they're good people and they're they're competitive and they can handle the stress of being a professional athlete.
Can you go a little bit deeper than that for us, though? I mean, what are you actually looking for?
I look for guys who really have resilience. A lot of times they have had an easy life, some of them, and so really understanding that they can handle the challenge, they can handle setbacks, especially with a lot of these guys, they've been great players and they haven't had a lot of failure. And so when they get to the next level, it's harder for them.
Is this a make or break process? Can you look at somebody entirely differently after they've come through the interview?
I don't think so. I think it's just another piece of information. It usually confirms a lot of what we already know about the guys because our scouts do such an amazing job throughout the years of watching them and getting to see them and talking to them, that this is another piece of information. So what we find might move them up or down a slot, but not dramatically.
The question here tonight, of course, on everybody's mind, is it Nico Hischier? Is it Nolan Patrick? Were there any common denominators between the two and how they would have reacted to your line of questioning?
They were very similar in their competitiveness. They were similar in their motivation. They both are driven to succeed, which I think is what you find in a lot of these guys. What I liked about both of them, they're very easygoing, easy to talk to. I got to have dinner with both of them, so I got to know them a lot longer than the 20 minutes at the combine.
This is your very first draft. What are you most looking forward to tonight?
Seeing who we pick.
You don't even know.
I don't know. He's not telling anybody, so it's exciting for all of us right now.
Dr. Amy Kimball, thank you so much. Darren, back to you.
Oh, there's somewhere in there the sports psychology, but she's got to be able to figure it out.
That's awesome.
I threw it up.
Close to the vest.
Sports psychologist, nothing new here, but she does handle more than we've seen in the past.
Well, it's very fascinating how this works, because when you go to the NHL Combine, it's a big part of what happens in deciding who to take. And I can tell you for certain that there's one prospect that had a very difficult time in the process, and a lot of teams moved him down a lot more significantly than Dr. Kimball would have said. But there are teams that use Navy SEAL recruiters. There are teams that put a group of 10 or 12 guys around you. There are teams that use psychology, sequential questioning, in order to find out exactly what that player is all about.
Navy and SEAL, then, you said?
Navy SEALs. Yeah. So you're trying to find out the things that would make a Navy SEAL person tick. They're trying to find out those similar things. So it's absolutely fascinating, the whole interview process, and it does have an impact.
It's like Hell Week. They're trying to get you to ring the bell a little bit.
Yeah.
You know, trying to rattle your cage a little bit. But listen, this is a mental game, and they want to know how far these players can get pushed, what they're going to do with adversity, because once you get to that stage, there's no turning back. There's only one way, and it's to go forward. So this is a real useful tool, I think, for young players talking to somebody like Amy to kind of get a little gist of what's going to go on the next step.
The general managers that hold the number one and two draft choices in conversation there with Shiro and Hextall. Sports psychologist is one thing, trying to determine what's going on in your head with Nico Hischier and Nolan Patrick. But how about this at the draft combine? They did an event and they're standing there, and who's looking over their shoulder? Look at those eyes. If that doesn't make you take stock of yourself and say, we got something on our shoulders here that we got to protect, it's the rocket over the shoulder of Nolan Patrick and Nico Hischier. Interview is an intimidating process, but then we throw a camera in their face and everything goes kind of sideways as we meet the future, the 2017 draft prospects here in Chicago.
My name is Nico Hischier. I'm Nolan Patrick.
Kael McCarr.
I'm Cody Glass.
I'm Pierre-Olivier Joseph.
Casey Mittelstadt, forward from Eden Prairie, Minnesota. I should probably do that again. Three things the average fan wouldn't know about me is...
Ooh, that's a tough one.
Something someone might not know about me is I really like to sing.
I don't really have three things. I need to think about this one.
You know that thing, like it's the paddle ball?
Yeah.
I can do that like for so long.
I know some songs, but like I wouldn't sing in front of a camera right now.
When I had my surgery last summer, somebody dropped it off in a gift basket and I just sat in bed just crying in this thing.
I love doing school at home alone in the during the weekend.
My favorite player is Paolo Datsyuk.
My favorite player is Erik Karlsson.
Sidney Crosby.
Danny Briere.
PK Subban.
I don't even know who my favorite player is. Give me a second, I think of someone.
Obviously, he's the best player in the world.
Growing up, I like the celebration.
He's always enjoying to be on the ice.
I watched always his highlights, and he's just my favorite player.
I'm actually really superstitious. Something that bugs me is my stick length. I can never cut my sticks the same length, and it drives me nuts.
I'm not a very superstitious guy, so it's kind of a tough one.
If I'm using a white stick, I use white tape, or a silver stick, I use white tape.
white tape. If I'm using black stick, I use black tape. I'm on the bottom, I always use white on the top.
A player I'd compare myself with is probably Mark Scheifele.
Oh, man.
I try and model my game after John Tavares.
Like Pavel Datsyuk.
Shane Gauthier, Erik Karlsson kind of mix.
Anze Kopitar.
Marc-Edouard Vlasic with the San Jose Sharks.
If I had to play any song that I got drafted to, probably be like Welcome to the Jungle or something like that.
One Dance from Drake.
Let me look through some songs on my phone quick here.
That's tough too. You guys are getting really tough on these. Usually in Minnesota, they just leave them easy.
What's the weirdest one somebody said? If I had a song to walk up to at the draft, it'd be It Ain't Me by Selena Gomez. I don't want to embarrass myself too much, that's for sure.
It was the song question that seemed to stump everybody. The paddleball, though, had a scrambling, if that was the official name of it. Nolan Patrick, where will his ball land tonight? And Nico Hischier, headed for the New Jersey Devils. Ray Shiro discussing things with Vegas Golden Knights general manager George McPhee, has had an eventful week. John McDonough greeting the hometown Chicago Blackhawk fans as we get ready to chat with Elliot Friedman with an update here, getting set for the first round of the National Hockey League Draft presented by Adidas in Chicago.
Closed captioning brought to you by Canada Post. Delivering more parcels to Canadians than anyone. Canada Post, delivering the online world.
Every bottle of Sleeman has a story, and our Railside Session Ale is no exception. Back in the 1800s, on the way to our brewery, hops would fall by the railside. Those hops are still growing wild there today. They're the inspiration for our Railside Session Ale, a distinctly flavorful beer with a crisp finish. We hope you'll enjoy it as much as we did making it. Sleeman Railside Session Ale. It's notoriously good.
Schick Hydro, protecting mankind one face at a time. Schick Hydro, technology that transforms.
With 100% whole wheat for your grown-up side and a touch of sweet for the kid in you, Kellogg's Mini Wheats takes your grown-up day and adds a little play. Feed your inner kid with Kellogg's Mini Wheats.
In a few moments, we're going to be making our final descent into Las Vegas, but this is no ordinary WestJet flight. Now please look out those left-hand windows in 3, 2, 1. Congratulations, seat number 4A. Yeah, you just got a WestJet VIP Vegas upgrade.
Of course it's cold. It's Jan. It's good to be the master.
Jägermeister.
The NBA Awards, Monday on Sportsnet 1.
Tuesday afternoon in Las Vegas, the National Hockey League and Adidas unveiled the much-anticipated Vegas Golden Knights new jerseys and uniforms at an event. They also unveiled the new look for the rest of the National Hockey League teams for the upcoming season. Brent Burns, San Jose Sharks, was in attendance, and big man likes what he sees.
I'm like everybody else. I want it to look good, and I always think if you look good, you feel good, and you play good.
John McDonough continues his welcome. You may have heard the cheering and the odd boos during the course of our pre-draft show. That was Jim Gregory from the National Hockey League going through the roll call process, one of the traditions here in the first round of the NHL draft. Darren Millard back with Sam Cosentino and Louis DeBrusque. And there is Elliot Friedman on the draft floor. Elliot.
Just a note before the draft begins, Darren. There, as we all know, earlier this week, Mark Methot was selected by Las Vegas from Ottawa in the expansion draft. And there was some talk about whether or not Las Vegas would flip him to another team. I understand that the Montreal Canadiens asked for permission to talk to Methot. They wanted to see if they could work out a trade. Montreal is on Methot's no trade list. I'm told he considered it, he thought about it, but at the end of the day he decided to stick to his list. I think that he was careful about not offending the Canadians. He just said that he created the list for a reason and he wanted to stick with that. So that potential trade is not going to happen. Darren?
Thank you, Elliot. And it's in those rules where you can't select a player and then trade him right back to his former team. So if you're wondering about the Ottawa Senators and a potential reunion with Mark Methot, that's not going to happen. Vegas Golden Knights pick sixth. They had the third best odds in the draft lottery, but they fell down because of New Jersey and Philadelphia and Dallas all moving up so much. So Vegas will pick 6, 13, and 15 as we bring in Gene Honda.
As we honor both Canada and the United States with the singing of the national anthems of both countries as performed by Jim Cornelison.
Oh, Canada, terra de nos aïeux, ton prince de fleur en glorie, car ton bras s'est porté l'épée, il s'est porté la croix. Ton histoire est une épopée des plus brillants exploits. God keep our land glorious and free. Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight for the ramparts we so gallantly streaming and the rockets raging, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, for the land of the free and the home of the brave.
Jim Cornelius, so many times you stood at center ice at the United Center and belted out the anthems, one of the most electric places in the National Hockey League. And today he's got the stage at the NHL draft in the opening round. As we get ready, Chicago will pick 26th, the first Canadian team at 5 at the United Center on Sportsnet.
The 2017 NHL Draft, presented by Adidas.
Atoms are all around us. When these electrostatic charges draw together, they constitute a chemical bond. They create powerful, eternal connections.
Bumped?
Bumped.
Why do they even call it bumped?
Are they trying to make it sound fun? Like, ooh, I've been bumped.
How is it okay that they sold my seat twice and now I can't get to my meeting, even though I paid for that seat?
I'm gonna get another call from my boss.
I can't get another call from my boss.
If I owned an airline, I'd make sure everyone gets the seat they paid for.
Actually, at WestJet, we don't overbook our flights.
Really?
It's just one of the ways we do business differently.
Sportsnet Now, live stream sports. Visit snnow.ca for details.
hype, years in the making, crescendo of hockey evaluation. The scouts all have opinions about the world's emerging talent, but nobody knows these boys transitioning into men like Mom. You know, if they weren't so chiseled, it would make your heart melt.
I remember you had this dream. It was so far away, almost unattainable. You had this burning desire to be the best.
Nolan Patrick!
The dream kept evolving. It became something bigger than a fantasy.
He scores! Kyler Yamamoto!
You knew to achieve your goal, you had to work hard. Endless hours of skating, stick handling, refining your game.
Really? Come on, Mikey boy.
With every workout, you grew stronger. With every failure, every victory you developed.
Eagles are going to state!
Now it's your time to follow in the footsteps of your idols.
Shoot, scores! Wow!
To walk up those steps into history.
You should be very proud of yourself. This is awesome.
Enjoy the moment. You've made it. Tonight, your dream will be realized.
That's a title nobody needs to explain. Hockey Mom says it all. It's the 2017 National Hockey League Draft, the opening round on Sportsnet presented by Adidas. Welcome, everybody. Darren Millard here, along with Sam Cosentino from the Canadian Hockey League on Sportsnet, and drafted 1989 Louis DeBrusque from the New York Rangers. This is one of the most wide-open first rounds we've seen.
Yeah, it's pretty wild because it really starts at pick number three. So what's going to happen at number one and two? Is there going to be a trade at the top? And then you look at the Vegas Golden Knights, 6, 13, and 15. They've owned the hockey world for the last couple of days. They may own it again here tonight.
And this is when it gets really real for these families down there. I was there a couple of years ago with my son Jake, and let me tell you, it's the quiet before the storm. They want this to get started.
The National Hockey League Draft will feature the New Jersey Devils picking first overall. They jumped those four spots in the lottery. Philadelphia moved up 13 positions, and Dallas goes in the third spot. Then you see the teams that fell back between Colorado. Vancouver's the first Canadian club at number five, second straight year. And then you get the other Canadian team, starting with Calgary at number 16. Elliot Friedman, part of our group covering this opening round. He's on the draft floor. Elliot.
Darren, no questions. We arrived here this afternoon. One of the most popular people was Islanders general manager Gar Snow, with trade rumors about Travis Hamonic all over the place. He held a lengthy conversation with several general managers, including Lou Lamoriello of the Maple Leafs, for about 7 minutes. And then there was that was caught by cameras. Every handshake is incredibly scrutinized here. Ray Shiro has the number one pick. The Vegas Golden Knights have number six. We'll see if that handshake meant anything more than just good luck. Jeff Merrick. Jeff?
Hey, thanks very much. Here in the green room, never been done at the NHL level before. Tonight, we are making history at the NHL draft. 8 high-end first-round draft picks, from Nico Hischier to Nolan Patrick to Gabe Vilardi to Owen Tippett to Cody Glass, are right beside me. Here's what's happening. When their name is called, they will go and pick out a hat from the hat rack here. They will take off their jackets. They will get up onto the stage. They will shake the commissioner's hand, and then they will meet their new team. To Tara Sloan. Tara?
Well, I've got a pretty good seat here. I've got a good view of the stage, good view of the floor here. But the real question is, who will be the first to sit in this seat beside me? Will it be Nico? And will it be Nolan? Now, one thing is for sure, the two seem to have forged a pretty close bond over the past 6 months. This is a photo of the two from the scouting combine in Buffalo. When we asked Nolan what he and Nico were talking about, he said they were comparing notes on which restaurants they've been taken to by the teams. Suffice it to say, the two have been eating well. Darren?
I love it because they're saying, if I went to a better restaurant, I've got a better chance of going first overall. Commissioner Gary Bettman kicks off the draft next on Sportsnet.
Because you always love me, oh, what I wouldn't do. I'll carry you away.
Oh,
Here's the truth, the bold truth about your oral care routine. You think that your bleeding gums are from brushing too hard, but that may not be true. It could be a sign of early gum disease. Fortunately, it can be reversed and prevented by adding Listerine. And it's not just us that think so. The Canadian Dental Association validates that adding Listerine to your oral care routine prevents early gum disease better than brushing and flossing alone. Be bold with your routine and add Listerine.
Nothing is better than a Swiss Chalet quarter chicken dinner. Juicy, fresh, never frozen rotisserie chicken, golden fresh cut fries, and that famous Chalet sauce. But wait, two of them for just $14.99? I stand corrected. This offer is only here for 14 days until June 25th.
Bumped?
Bumped.
Why do they even call it bumped?
Well, they're trying to make it sound fun, like, ooh, I've been bumped.
How is it okay that they sold my seat twice and now I can't get to my meeting, even though I paid for that seat?
I'm going to get another call from my boss.
I can't get another call from my boss.
If I owned an airline, I'd make sure everyone gets the seat they paid for.
Actually, at WestJet, we don't overbook our flights.
Really?
It's just one of the ways we do business differently.
This is it. One chance. Against the best in the world. And that's cool with me.
New Gatorade Frost, play cool.
50,000 fans waiting on a pitch, full count. And that's cool with me.
New Gatorade Frost, play cool.
I was wondering if an electric toothbrush really cleans better than a manual, and my hygienist says it does, but they're not all the same. Turns out they're really different. Who knew? I had no idea. So she said, look for one that's shaped like a dental tool with a round brush head.
Go pro with Oral-B. Oral-B's rounded brush head surrounds each tooth to gently remove more plaque. And Oral-B cross-action is clinically proven to remove more plaque than Sonicare Diamond Clean.
My mouth feels so clean. I'll only use an Oral-B.
The number one brand used by dentists worldwide. Oral-B. Brush like a pro.
Brandon Weeking has never gone first overall. The highest drafted Swiss player is 5 in 2010. Nolan Patrick, Nico Hischier, out to make history. The first pick after Commissioner Gary Bettman.
Hello, Chicago. A sellout and among the loudest arenas in the league. It must be the United Center. Thank you. Our first draft in Chicago after 54 years. We're finally happy to be here with an original six set of fans and a great city. So again, thank you for this energetic welcome. Tonight, you can do it. You can do better than that. That's more like it. Tonight will be remembered as our centennial draft as we celebrate 100 years of NHL hockey. And it's our first draft with 31 teams. So welcome to the Vegas Golden Knights. We are really delighted to be here at the United Center, home to great hockey moments and clearly great fan passion. Again, thank you for your warm welcome to the entire NHL family. Thank you as well, Rocky Wirtz, John McDonough, Jay Blunk, and Mayor Rahm Emanuel for your hospitality. Thank you, Adidas, for sponsoring this draft and for the new Adizero jerseys that that will make their on-ice debut this coming season. Greetings to our viewing audiences on NBC Sportsnet, Rogers Sportsnet, and TVA, and hello to those watching at team viewing parties around the league, and to those listening on Sirius XM, NHL Radio, and Sportsnet Radio Network. There are a great number of young men and their families who have been dreaming about this moment for years. They and all of you are eager to get started on a night that means so much to our teams and to our game. So good luck to everyone. And so, Chicago, here we go. The first selection of the 2017 NHL Draft belongs to the New Jersey Devils.
New Jersey won the draft lottery, jumped up four spots that first overall pick. General Manager Ray Shero has been extremely active on the draft floor for the last 45 minutes, engaging conversations from everyone, from Ron Hextall, who are picking at number two, and we also saw a lengthy discussion with George McPhee. The Vegas Golden Knights have three picks inside the first 15 selections. Sam Cosentino and Louis DeBrusque here with me on the panel. How much do you think there's been a debate here whether New Jersey actually holds on to this first pick, which is a bonus to them, or they slide back in a very wide open draft?
I think it's been a huge debate, and here's the reason. When you look at being found money, taking that number one pick, you say, all right, we've really got nothing to lose. If we can add assets or add more picks, then we'll go and do that. But when you look at New Jersey the last couple of years, Michael McLeod, Pavel Zacha, John Quenneville were their first round picks. It's easy to see why they'd want to go to a defenseman in Cale Makar. Will they have the moxie to go and do that, or will the pick be traded? Everyone looking pretty cool down there right now.
Influenced at all, do you think, because they already have their corner piece in Taylor Hall? They made the big trade last year, but they have that forward. They might go in a different direction.
You know, it could very well go that way. You know, Nico Hischier and Nolan Patrick are the top-rated two prospects in this draft, but for the New Jersey Devils right now, Ray Shero has talked about he needs bodies in all different positions. So you know what, they can be a little bit flexible here and move around to look for the player they feel fits the need most right now. And there's other teams, no doubt, because of the conversations that we're having on the floor down there, that they're interested in that top pick.
New wrinkles to this draft, Chicago putting its own spin on it with the anthems and Jim Cornelius, so it was splendid again. Also, eight prospects are sequestered behind the stage in the green room. And what do you talk about when you're number one rated prospect and you're being chased down by number two and Nico Hischier and Nolan Patrick? It's interesting what they find the common ground in.
What color? Like, it's like
dark green.
Dark green, yeah.
That's nice.
Mapu.
Oh, look at you.
Mamu.
Real deal, eh?
Oh, he's got to check out the label to see what you're wearing. Swiss class, though, Nico Hischier. He exudes it, and Nolan Patrick has that swagger about him.
Well, you look at Roger Federer. I know both of you guys are fans of Roger Federer.
Big
Doesn't he have that kind of air about him, that presence about him that Roger Federer has when you're talking about Nico Hischier?
Yeah. That's what you said, Darren. Swiss class, right?
Do one of these players fit the New Jersey Devils more than another?
I think Nico Hischier does, you know, just because he's quicker.
Ray Shero with the number one pick. Gary Bettman welcoming Ray Shero to the stage. Taking over, Tommy Fitzgerald is the assistant general manager. They worked together in Pittsburgh for a time.
On behalf of the New Jersey Devils organization and our ownership group, Josh Harris and David Blitzer, I want to thank the city of Chicago, John McDonough, Mr. Wirtz. Also want to say hello to our tremendous fans back in Newark, New Jersey at our draft festival. With our first selection in the 2017 entry draft, the New Jersey Devils are proud to welcome from the Halifax Mooseheads, Nico Hischier.
if you look back a year ago, this is a massive shock. Not so much in the last couple of months, but where Nico Hischier has come from, it's not left field, but it's deep shortstop.
Well, no question about it. And you think about going back to him playing with men a couple of years ago for Guy Boucher in the Burn system and then making his way to the Halifax Mooseheads. But the Halifax Mooseheads must know what they're doing. Cam Russell and Bobby Smith, the group there, have selected Nikolai Ehlers, Timo Meyer, another Swiss player, Jonathan Drouin, Nathan MacKinnon. And when you talk to their coaching staff, what they say about Nico Hischier is the fact that his game is more rounded than all of those players at this age. Doesn't mean that he's going to be one of those players, but at this age, for those other guys, this guy's a more well-rounded player.
Super emotional after the pick, too. The highest Swiss-born player ever to be picked in the National Hockey League draft. And you know, when you look at Nico Hischier and the way he climbed and the pressure that he was under, that's the most impressive thing for me. He heard the noise, but he went through that noise and played his best hockey right down the stretches. The bigger stage for him, the bigger he played. That told me that he was a tremendous hockey player and going to move forward. Great pick by the New Jersey Devils.
38 goals this year, 86 points, rookie of the year in the QMJHL. There's so little to separate between themselves. His family goes through a multitude of emotions just as a family member, and then you just think about what's at stake here and what this means to Swiss hockey. He loves the shootout. He would watch Pavel Datsyuk's highlights for the KHL, and he's a 200-foot player. When you're comparing a Canadian kid to the Euros, a lot of times you say the Euros got some flair. He ticks off all the boxes.
No question about it. And I think his coming out party, you go back to the World Juniors, in particular the game against the U.S., where he was so dynamic that he almost single-handedly beat the U.S. in that game. Of course, the U.S. went on to beat Canada and win gold. But Bob Motzko, the head coach at St. Cloud, who was the head coach for the U.S., said, "This guy was the best guy we faced all tournament long." And I think that speaks volumes coming from a gold medal winning coach.
And you know, for me, it's the balance points. When you watch him play the game, he makes it look effortless the way he moves because he's so strong on his edges and the balance points that he has. And for me, that just tells me it's a guy that's really put together in that direction. Not so dynamic necessarily, but he gets the job done every time.
He's a player that the more you watch, the more you enjoy.
Yep.
He's got this dedication and this commitment that makes him a coach's dream. But when you look at the next level, what do you think he can progress to? If we don't have that generational talent this year, what is Nico Hischier?
Well, the National Hockey League is such a copycat league. When the LA Kings won, everyone said we have to go big. When the Pittsburgh Penguins won, we said we have to go small and speedy. But I look at Nashville against Pittsburgh, and you feel just how fast the game was, the speed of the game. And I think Nico Hischier is able to bring that to the game. Handle the puck at high speeds. Puck possession type of guy. Make sure you're carrying the puck as opposed to dumping it in and chasing it. And he fits that bill.
Down to Jeff Merrick, who's got the family connection. Jeff?
Yeah, Darren, thanks very much. And Nico Hischier's father just handed me this card. This is Nico Hischier at 9 years old wearing a New Jersey Devils jersey. Perhaps some foreshadowing of what we've seen so far this evening as he goes first overall. Standing by with brother Luca. Who's more nervous, you or Nico, today?
I think right now it's me. Before also I was pretty nervous too. I think the whole family. Nico also, I never saw him like that. But now it's good. We enjoy the evening.
He wears number 13, not for Pavel Datsyuk, although that is his favorite player. He says he wears number 13 for you. What's your relationship like with Nico?
I have a really good relationship with him. He's like my best friend. We can talk like everything, and also in private, and not just hockey. It's just, yeah, he's just my best friend.
It's wonderful to see. A wonderful family moment. Congratulations to the Hischier family. Elliot.
If Ray Shiro had two choices, whether or not to keep the pick or whether or not, and which player to take. First of all, did anyone even tempt you in terms of trading the pick?
No, they really didn't, Elliot. I think, we were pretty focused on Nico the entire time, and the chance to maybe trade down and collect assets doing that, at the end it didn't make sense to us, obviously. So I'm thrilled to get Nico here at number one. It's a big thing for our franchise.
You said that you were focused on him the whole time. What did you like that made him the edge?
Well, I mean, I say that respectfully. It was a hard decision coming down, and with Nolan Patrick and Cal Makar and Heiskanen and some other, there's some very good players here, but having spent a lot of time with Nolan and Nico and even Heiskanen over in Helsinki, went to visit all these guys. You got to take the emotion out of it, because I like to take all of them. They're fantastic kids, and they're all going to be really good players in this league.
Thanks very much, Ray.
I appreciate it.
Tara?
Well, thank you very much, Elliot.
Your stock kept rising throughout the year. When did you actually let yourself believe that this was a possibility?
Well, I just can't believe it right now. I mean, I'm sitting right now here and I can't believe it. And yeah, my biggest goal is playing the NHL. I know I gotta work hard for that, and that I'm gonna be here, that's a step goal for me, and it feels awesome. I can't describe the feelings.
You've made history. What kind of party is happening in your hometown in Switzerland?
Well, a couple of my buddies for sure are gonna look this draft, and yeah, they're gonna be happy for me 100%, and yeah, it's just awesome. I feel awesome, yeah.
Nico, congratulations to you.
Thank you very much.
Darren?
Tara, thank you. The Philadelphia Flyers have the second overall pick, jumping up 13 spots by way of the draft lottery. A no-brainer that they go with Nolan Patrick then?
Well, you'd have to think so. I mean, there's the guy, Ron Hextall, Brandon Wheat Kings, former Brandon Wheat Kings star, so you'd have to think at some point there is a good connection there.
Ron Hextall, the general manager and vice president of the Philadelphia Flyers, with the second overall pick.
Philadelphia selects from the Western Hockey League's Brandon Wheat Kings, Nolan Patrick.
Has to be a thrill. Like, Ron Hextall has been through everything in the game. Stanley Cup Finals, Conn Smythe trophies. He's a born Brandon guy. And gets to draft as a general manager somebody from his junior team in the Brandon Wheat Kings. If Nolan Patrick doesn't have the double hernia injury and then the subsequent surgery that limited him to 33 games this year, do you think he goes first overall, or was it the injury that made him drop?
Well, I certainly think he would have made it a much more interesting battle, no question about it. Look, 2 years ago when he had 102 points as a 16 turning 17 year old in Brandon to win the WHL championship, that was the player that I watched and that I saw, and I believe the Philadelphia Flyers are getting. When this guy's fully healthy, he's a beast, and I think he's the most NHL ready guy in the pack.
Philadelphia was in a great spot because they could sit there and wait to see who went number one and knew they were going to get a great player at number two. So it's a perfect situation to be in, while at the same time being able to listen to offers, see if someone wants to move up and acquire assets. You held the keys sitting in that number two spot. What I like about Nolan Patrick, though, you go back to his 16-year-old year, and he was thrown into every single situation by Kelly McCrimmon, who was at that time the coach of the Brandon Wheat Kings. Whether it was defending 3-on-5, whether it's the last minute of a game, looking for a goal to try and tie a game, he played in every single situation. The other thing you have to know about him, he's a late birthday. So he had the opportunity to be seen for 2 years. Even though he was hurt this year, there was still a good enough book on him over 2 years to kind of make that determination of what he would be.
Nolan Patrick, wall to wall as the number one rated prospect, slips down to number two, goes to the Philadelphia Flyers. Centerman, he's big, he can score, also likes to dish the puck, good on the faceoff.
Yeah, for me it's the playmaking abilities of a big man. I think of Ryan Getzlaff. You know, he talks about Andrei Kopitar, what a great guy to look up to, but for Patrick, he can possess the puck, he can get to a position, hold guys off, and then make that crucial play. That's what makes him so successful.
Second straight year, the Philadelphia Flyers take a Wheat King in the first round. Tara.
Nolan, we've been watching you a lot this year, and that was the brightest smile that I have ever seen from you. What does that come from? Do you feel comfortable in that uniform, or is it a sense of relief at this point?
A little bit of both. You know, for me, it was a tough year, and, you know, obviously no one wants to be hurt, and especially in the draft year, but, you know, Philly was a team that, you know, if I went there, I'd be really excited. And, you know, I know Ivan Provorov there, one of my good buddies. So, you know, I'm really happy to get started, and, you know, it's a huge honor.
What kind of conversations have you been having with Ron Hextall?
I met with him in Philly about 2 weeks ago when I was there. And, you know, he was awesome to me the whole time. And, you know, he said they wanted me if they had a chance. So, you know, I'm very honored to be here.
Your dad and uncle both drafted into the NHL. Have they been taking a bit of a trip down memory lane being here in Chicago with you?
Yeah, they were saying it's a little different when they were drafted. You know, my dad was mowing the lawn and his buddy called him because he heard on the radio. So I think things have changed a lot since back then.
And your dad has actually been really emphasizing mental toughness, which you have really needed this past year, of course, going through injury. How has that been implemented for you?
Yeah, my dad's been huge for me ever since I was young. I think, you know, when he played, he might have been a little tough on himself and a little too negative. So, you know, instilled that in me as a young age to you know, stay positive and, you know, work through anything. So he's been huge for me.
Nolan, congratulations to you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Elliot?
Thank you, Tara. Ron, was it as simple as let's just wait and see who goes in front of us?
Yeah, we felt like it would go, these two guys would go 1-2. We honestly didn't know until Ray picked Nico there who was going first and second, but we believe they're the top two players.
He said that you met with him 2 weeks ago face-to-face in Philadelphia. What were the important things in the conversation that you learned about him?
Well, we brought him in on the medical side of it. We actually had dinner with him at the Combine. We interviewed him as a group at the Combine. We had a quiet dinner with him, just two of us, trying to get to know the kid, understand what happened, the injuries, background on him as a player, background on him as a kid, how he grew up, just all the little things you want to know about a kid. And when he came down to Philly, it was predominantly for the medical part. We want our doctors and our trainers to get their hands on him, see how they felt, just in case he was there for us and our comfort level was there.
All the Brandon guys are good guys too, right?
Love it. Brandon, we kings.
All right, Darren?
You watch Ron Hextall play, and the way he banged those posts and was out there being physical, I have a hard time believing that there was a quiet dinner anywhere with him. Dallas Stars will pick third overall as they make their way. Jim Neal, the general manager, they've made a coaching change as well. This is a team with Ken Hitchcock taking over back. Which direction do you think they go now?
Well, I think that it's been commonly said that Miro Heiskanen is the direction in which they're going to go, and you haven't heard a lot about Dallas and moving their pick.
Here's Tom Gagliardi.
We would like to thank the city of Chicago for being host this week to the NHL draft. Stars would like to thank Rocky Wirtz, John McDonough, Stan Bowman, and the rest of the Chicago Blackhawks organization. And a warm hello to the magnificent fans of the Chicago Blackhawks. We also want to congratulate the Pittsburgh Penguins for winning the Stanley Cup. And a shout out to all our fans in Dallas and those at our draft party at the owner's box at the Omni. The Dallas Stars, with the third pick, are pleased to select from HIFK of the Finnish Liga, Miro Heiskanen.
There's your first defenseman. Yeah.
Well, if I go back and I look at what the Dallas Stars have done recently, you look at their last six picks, Riley Tufte last year, Gurionov the year before that, and then you get into Nichushkin, Jason Dickinson, Radek Faxa. Well, the guy in the middle of that is Julius Honka, and I don't know if he's progressed quite the way that they have expected him to, so they go back here and try and pick a defenseman. What's really interesting to know is that Jim Neal is the general manager, Joe McDonnell is their head scout. Those two guys worked a long time with the Detroit Red Wings. They were exposed to a guy by the name of Nicklas Lidström. You would know him from your draft year, Louis. A pretty darn good player in his own right. In fact, maybe the best defenseman to ever play the game next to Bobby York. So when it comes to Heiskanen, he plays a similar style game in that he plays a mistake-free game. He gives you two-way adaptability, and a guy who in the under-18s ended up with 12 points. So he played with men all year, performed well there, gets into his own age group, and performed even better with those 12 points at the under-18s. I think that cemented his spot here as number three.
Kind of fitting that he's drafted here in Chicago because he plays a lot like Keith Ballard does the Chicago Blackhawks. He can jump into that hole and become very offensive in a hurry, but he plays with that poise in both ends of the ice.
And you don't think he's saying Duncan Keith just to butter these people up?
No, absolutely not. This is a player that he models his game after, and that's a player that he plays like. It's a very fitting one because he plays exactly like that. Same type of size as Duncan Keith as well, and he has that explosive first couple strides to elude an opponent.
He was supposed to play for that junior club and just outplayed himself and moved up. The three lottery winners have made their selection. Nico Hischier, Nolan Patrick, Miro Heiskanen. 1-2-3 at the 2017 NHL Draft. The first round presented by Adidas continues on Sportsnet. Vancouver is up at 5 after Colorado.
Eastside Mario's Italian Food Festival is here! My new entrees on $12.99, like chicken cacciatore or pepperoni panzerotti with all-you-can-eat super salad and garlic home loaf. Only until June 25th. Dine in or order now. Eastside Mario's, having a boom and a...
Vinod's favorite color is red.
Green.
purple.
She likes to be pampered. She likes the spa.
He loves turkey.
Wow.
No, we don't have a financial plan.
She has an RSP, but you have an RSP, right?
No, I don't have an RSP.
No RSP, so.
When do you plan on retiring?
55, really, buddy? Really?
It's happening.
I don't think you know anything about mortgages.
You're comfortable with getting a loan, though, right? That it's a loan.
Yes, I know that.
He doesn't like talking about it because he's the spender.
Well, I was maybe thinking about a dirt bike for the summer.
Oh, yeah. No. No.
We should talk more, maybe more, about money.
I think we can do it.
Yep.
Florida United Center, the first time the city of Chicago has ever hosted a National Hockey League draft. The opening round on this Friday night on Sportsnet. 31 selections for the first time as the Vegas Golden Knights join the fray. New Jersey has picked Nico Hischier first overall, followed by Nolan Patrick by Philadelphia and Miro Heiskanen of the Dallas Stars. Vancouver is on the horizon at number 5, but up next is the Colorado Avalanche at number 4. The Adidas recap is number 17. I look at that, and I know it's a year, but I think Ilya Kovalchuk, and it'll be a long time. Still don't know whether he's going to return to the National Hockey League. And a Brandon Wheating connection, really, with Ron Hextall, Ivan Provorov, the defenseman taken last year in the first round, and now Nolan Patrick slips to number 2, and Miro Heiskanen joins the Dallas Stars on the blue line side of things. And the defensive picture, the Finnish defensive picture, really started to gain some momentum, but the consensus around that started to open up as far as who might go first in the defensive side of things. Now, Heiskanen's gone there, but Makar has made a name for himself and impressed a lot of people.
Well, I think there's a couple of tiers here for defensemen when it comes to this draft, and it's Heiskanen and Makar being in that first tier, and then you get into that second tier group. That would include Timothy Liljegren, who's been bumped down since the start of the year. That would include Cal Foote, the son of Adam Foote, former National Hockey Leaguer and longtime player, Stanley Cup winner. And that would include Juuso Välimäki of the Tri-City Americans, who a lot of people really like. That would be that second tier. But if you're looking at the first tier, Heiskanen first, Cale Makar would be the second guy in that first tier of defensemen available.
And if you're worried at all and think they might not go to Tier 2, the Alberta Junior Hockey League, they dipped into that market a year ago at Tyson Jost.
And I think that pick worked out really well. Got into some games at the end of the year in the National Hockey League. His rights are owned by the Regina Pats. It's to be determined whether or not he makes Colorado coming out of camp or goes back into junior playing for the Pats, as they will be the host of the 100th MasterCard Memorial Cup.
To Joe Sakic.
Colorado Avalanche are proud to select from Brooks their Alberta Junior Hockey League, Cale Makar.
So, a lot like we saw the first overall pick in Nico Hischier, who worked his way into consideration and then started stealing the show. Cale Makar has a similar track record here. And he is offense, and maybe looks at his blue line and then goes offense.
Arguably the most dynamic player, not just defenseman, but player in the draft. This guy can do wonders when he has the puck on his stick, and that's what all the scouts and all the teams loved about this kid. This is the new National Hockey League, being able to take a puck, do good things with it, protect it. This guy is fearless jumping up in the rush, but you just love his shot, you love his hockey sense. People talked about his size a little bit, not being that big of a guy, but he's getting bigger by the day, he's getting stronger, going to university will do wonders for him.
Still,
this
though,
is a great pick.
5'11", fourth overall. That gives you the signal that it has changed.
That's the new game.
Well, it seems like in the National Hockey League, you have to have three of those type of defensemen. If you go back 7 or 8 years ago, you'd have that one power play guy who could be high risk in his ventures. Now it's like you have to have three of those guys. So when I look at this guy and everyone says, oh, you can't judge a guy in the Alberta Junior Hockey, the guy say, no, wait a second. Let's go back 2 years ago to the World Junior A Challenge in Ontario. He was on a defensive corps. Dennis Chalowski, first round pick last year. He was on a defensive corps. That same Dante Fabro, also part of that team. And this guy was equally as good, made the All-Star team that year. They go to the RBC Cup. He's the MVP there. The next year they come back, World Junior A Challenge, arguably the best player there. They go to the RBC Cup, arguably the best player there. So it's not just what the AJHL has to offer him, but in international competition and in two national championships, he might have been the best player in three of those last four events, and that was as allowed him to be picked fourth
by Colorado.
Tara Sloan with the newest member of the Colorado Avalanche.
Well, from working in a food truck at the Calgary Stampede to wearing a Colorado Avalanche jersey, Cale Makar, what do you make of all this?
It kind of seems so cliche, but you just got to say you're speechless. I don't think I could have gone to a better organization to fit myself, and I can't be more excited right now. So, yeah.
The highest player ever drafted from the AJHL. Are you starting to see a trend? Are kids coming up to you and thinking maybe that's the route for me?
Definitely. I think seeing guys like Jost last year and Fabro and Chalowski, it kind of gives guys coming into the league hope, and it's pretty cool to realize that you're just one step closer to achieving your goal of playing in the NHL for sure.
Well, you certainly are. Congratulations
to you,
Cale.
Thank you very much.
Darren?
Highest drafted player ever out of the Alberta Junior Hockey League. First player I've ever talked with where he said mini sticks helped him in his skill development. But you see with the stick handling that he's displayed. Jim Benning at the Vancouver Canuck table, and on the phone as we peer in there. Vancouver Canucks for the second straight year will have the fifth overall selection. Had to really feel for Trevor Linden at the draft lottery, and that face just went almost white when they dropped back. With the second best odds to pick at the draft lottery, and they slipped down to number five. But Benning on the phone. Do we think they might move this pick?
Well, he told Elliott before that there was a trade-back possibility, but let's put that aside for a second. Let's look at some of the recent first-round picks. Nicholas Jensen, Brendan Gaunce, Jared McCann traded away. Jake Virtanen hasn't worked out quite the way that they have thought. And then you look at Hunter Shinkarak, another guy that was traded away. The Vancouver Canucks need to start to get things right, and I think they're off to a good start last year with picking Olli Juolevi, although some people wonder about that pick because Matt Tkachuk was taken sixth and was an impact player in the National Hockey League. If you want to have that patient approach, allow a defenseman like Juolevi to be drafted and then develop, play with the London Knights, a really good team. And it'll be fascinating here now to see who they go with as they continue in this rebuild process.
Trevor Linden was the representative of the last two draft lotteries in our Sportsnet Hockey Central studios. And when they dropped
for a second
straight year.
2017 NHL draft, along
second best odds.
Vancouver Canucks.
And they picked fifth, and yeah. The emotion, he kept it together, but when he was leaving the studio, I had a chance to talk to him. He said, don't expect to see me back here next year. Because it's disappointing you dropped those three spots. So what's the difference in a player that you might get at five instead of three?
Well, in this draft, it's really interesting because really I think everyone felt that the draft was going to start at three. So things really opened up from there on out. And what's the difference in that player? Well, you probably get a player who can play in the National Hockey League in the first couple of picks, and then it starts to tail off where you're looking at more of a longer developmental curve.
Brock Besser from 2 years ago was their first overall pick at 23 for the Vancouver Canucks, and he made his NHL debut, scored Olli Juolevi a year ago as we go to the podium. Oh, I thought they were going to send him up there. Gary Bettman providing a little bit of security. Here's Jim Benning.
We would like to welcome all our fans at our draft party at Rogers Arena. And with our first selection, we select from Timrå Elias Pettersson.
165 pounds, 6'1", but not a lot of weight there. Played in the second division in Sweden. 19 goals in 43 games. He's got that knack. What are they getting in this player?
There's a couple of things that stick out. When you go back to his club play with Timrå in the Allsvenskan, he played with a player named Jonathan Dahlin, the son of Alf Dahlin, who was a former Ottawa Senators prospect. Well, in the Burroughs trade, it was Dahlin who ended up coming over to Vancouver. When those two played on a line together, the chemistry was undeniable. When they were off the line from one another, both players suffered. So now you have two Vancouver prospects who have good chemistry. You think about the Vancouver Canucks. At some point, they're going to have to transition out of the Sedin era, and they might be doing it with two Swedes. Here, Pettersson, and then Dahlin that we've talked about. The other thing that you have to remember is that this guy went out for dinner, flew into Vancouver,
after the combine, went out for dinner with the Sedins, went out for dinner with Jim Benning, really got a feel for what it was going to be like. If you're talking about mentoring a Swedish playmaking center, who would you rather have than the Sedins to do that for you?
And I agree with you, Sam. I think this is a move for the future here up the middle for the Vancouver Canucks, an area of need for them. You look at, as you mentioned, Henrik Sedin not getting any younger, and then they have Bo Horvat. They're looking for that depth down the middle. Brandon Sutter's there as well. This is a guy that can step in a couple of years, and he plays that poise game that most Swedes do. The thing I love about him most, though, this kid just makes plays, and that's what you love about young players.
Bit of a perimeter player. Scouts wondering whether that's just about survival or whether or not the frame just doesn't allow you to go there.
6'2", so yep. He's going to fill out.
We're looking forward to the launch of Sportsnet 650 Radio in Vancouver, the new home of the Vancouver Canucks. Wonder how long it'll be before we see Elias in the fold. Here's Tara.
Well, we just saw a shot of your parents. What did they say to you at that moment when you heard your name called?
We didn't talk too much. It was a special moment. I tell them I love them really much, so it was a special moment.
I know you also feel like you owe a lot to your brother. Your brother was drafted in 2013 by the Nashville Predators. What was that moment like for you, and then what do you think he's feeling right now?
I hope he's proud of me. when he got drafted, we were home in Sweden, in Ånge. I was sleeping, and then I woke up for them screaming, and it was a cool moment when he got drafted by Nashville, too.
Well, a few screams in Sweden for you tonight. Congratulations to you.
Thank you.
Elliot?
Tara, an hour ago, Jim Benning was right here, and he said that there's a playmaking center available. That's our guy. Was he always your guy?
Yeah, he's the guy that we honed in on. When we watched him play all year, traded for Jonathan Dahlin. They were teammates, so we spent a lot of time watching them. At the combine, we really liked him, brought him in to Vancouver. We were looking for a playmaking center iceman, a player that makes players around him better, and we feel that he does that.
Sam Cosentino mentioned that we came to Vancouver, he met you for dinner, he went for dinner with the Sedins. How much does that factor in your decision?
Well, we really got to know him as a person. He's a real good kid, so we're very excited to draft him, and he's got some good mentors in the Sedins. We're going to be patient with them, but we think we got a real good player going forward.
Thanks very much, Jim.
Thanks, Elliot.
Vancouver Canucks at number 5 for the second straight year, and not a lot of people going into this draft had the switch with Heischer and Patrick, but I have to give Sam Cosentino credit. You're 5 for 5 now between your mock draft and what's played out here.
Bang on.
Well, I think things really changed with Pettersson. I don't think a lot of people had him going that high. I felt pretty strongly about my information. I think the dinner with the Sedins is probably something that not getting enough credit when Jim Benning talks about it, but here you go. This is a guy that the only concern that you'd have about him is at 160 pounds, how much weight is he going to be able to, put on to compete in the Western Conference?
Be a little bit of a break. So unusual compared to a year ago when we were all in the first 10 picks with the Canadian clubs. We'll have the Vancouver Canucks giving way to the Calgary Flames at 16 and Toronto at 17, and then get into the likes of Edmonton, Winnipeg, Montreal, and Ottawa. How far away do you think?
Understand is he finished 9th in Allsvenskan scoring, and that's playing with men, even slight aside. Yes, it's a bigger ice surface. Yes, it's not quite as physical a league, but still finished 9th in scoring there. You look at the highlights, pretty dynamic player.
Really hard to predict that with the wiry players like him at 6'2". I do believe over a couple of years, though, he's going to fill up.
George McPhee, ready to make history. Gerard Gallant looking on.
We would like to say hello to all of our fans at T-Mobile Arena in Las Vegas. Thank you very much for your support. Vegas Golden Knights are pleased to select from the Portland Winterhawks of the Western Hockey League, Cody Glass.
A couple of nights ago in Vegas, the NHL Awards and then the expansion draft, you looked at that list that the Vegas Golden Knights selected, and the question mark was where is all the offense going to come from? Well, in 1 year, 2 years, this will be the part because this kid loves to score.
It's an unbelievable story. And if you haven't had the opportunity to see it, get on to sportsnet.ca, because the story of this young man is simply phenomenal. We had Amy Kimball on, the psychology doctor for the New Jersey Devils, in our pregame. And what you talked about is the resiliency of players. I don't know if there's a more resilient player in this draft. You go back to his childhood when he was separated from his brother. His father got in a long custody battle, finally won both brothers over. Then they had to live with their grandmother because they didn't have any money, paying for all the lawyers to go through the divorce. His father had to raise money for him with charitable events so that he could play high-level hockey in the Winnipeg area. And then finally he loses his grandmother, gets cut from the under-18s in August, and you think things are going to go sideways. What does he do? He comes back and has an unbelievable year. 94 points in the Western Hockey League for the Portland Winterhawks.
That's a 67-point upswing for him, and from year one to year two.
He went from a second, third-round pick.
Yeah, he just climbed the charts, and that's one of the things he said. Being cut from that U18 team really motivated him to put his best foot forward and just continue to work, and he didn't hear the noise outside of it. You love this kid. When we talked to him in Buffalo at the Combine, great personality, a smile on his face. He talked about singing. Just a real good kid here, Dave Gettins.
Kellen Kerman, the assistant general manager up there with George McPhee. Jeff Merrick.
Darren, thanks very much. Alongside Cody Glass's father, Jeff. I don't know who's happier right now. These are tears of joy in your eyes. You know, in the future we have of your son, he talks about how grandma would be so proud right now. What's going through your mind, Jeff?
Her for sure. The family behind me, the hard work he's put in, it's just all paid off, and I don't know what to say. I'm speechless.
You know, anyone who's ever spoken to your son comes away with the feeling that he's a special young man. He's respectful, he's hardworking, he loves his family. Are you prouder of Cody Glass, the player, or Cody Glass, the person?
The person. The person, just what he's grown into and how he's developed as a person and a man now. It's amazing, and I could be more proud of him.
Sam Cosentino was just running down some of the challenges that your family has had all the way up with Cody's hockey and having to take a little break and the fundraising. And I can't help but thinking, now here you are backstage, your son's just been drafted into the NHL. All worth it?
Oh, for sure. I wouldn't hesitate to do it all over again. It's for both kids. It's something that was, I would never, ever think twice about it.
Congratulations to the Glass family.
Thank you very much.
There's Jeff Glass, proud father of Cody Glass, newest member of the Vegas Golden Knights. Darren?
There was one point where he wasn't going to be able to play at the higher level of the hockey in the minor hockey system because they just couldn't afford it. Jeff had to tell Cody, sorry. And kids, they have trouble understanding that. Cody was great. He's with Tarasov.
Congratulations. Well, Cody, we were just taking a look at your dad, tears in his eyes. You say you've been looking forward to this moment for your whole life. Now that it's finally here after all of that, what's it like?
I can't really put it into words. I think I've gotten here, and the road I took is pretty bumpy, and it's something I've always wanted since I was a little kid, and I'm just super thankful that the day's finally here, and I'm proud to be a part of Las Vegas.
I know that you wish your grandmother Judy was here to share this with you. You lost her last year. If she were, what would you say to her?
Probably just thank her so much, because at a point I wasn't able to pay for hockey, and she was always there just helping along the way. And just with my family here, I'm just so happy they can experience it with me, because they're the ones who pushed me this far. And I just, it's really emotional for me. It's
the trade with the Arizona Coyotes, the New York Rangers with the first of two picks in this first round.
New York Rangers like to thank the Chicago Blackhawks and their fans for their hospitality this week. I'd like to congratulate Pittsburgh Penguins in the Stanley Cup. I will have my scout, Anders Kaller, is retiring after 10 years of pro hockey playing, 4 Stanley Cups, and 29 years of scouting. He's going to announce our pick.
New York Rangers select from HV71, Elias Andersson.
You know, this is a player that has earned a top 10 selection, because he went about this the hard way. He has a family connection in Sweden with the hockey club, and he chose to play for a different organization than his dad did, because he wanted to earn the ice time, earn the opportunity himself. He'll go back and he'll play for Frölunda, but before he does that, he wanted to make sure that he did it on his terms.
I love that. And to think that nepotism would have led to favoritism in terms of ice time or getting power play time or high leverage situations, that wasn't for him. And I think that only comes from being in an NHL family. When you look at his father, he's a scout now for the LA Kings, and his uncle played in the National Hockey League over 700 games, so that's in the blood. I love how he wanted to chart his own path. I think that's amazing. And when you talked about character and compete and all those sorts of things, Leos Andersson definitely has all those characteristics.
You know, when I played with his uncle Mikael in Tampa Bay, and I'll tell you, he was a relentless worker, dogged on the puck. And that's one of the things I see in Leos Andersson, is the fact that he worked himself into this position. He has that high-end skill, he has the hockey IQ, but it's the work ethic for me that makes this guy, I put him down as a sleeper in this draft. I love this guy as a player. I really think he's going to be a good NHL player because he plays the game the right way.
Coaches love him. His dad's a scout for the LA Kings now. As Leos Andersson goes number 7 to the New York Rangers, who made that trade to put themselves in a position to take the center left winger. Most emotional pick of these top 7, Cody Glass, Winnipeg born, plays in Portland, and is now a member of the Vegas Golden Knights. What a moment. Great feature on the website right now on Cody Glass, just documenting the journey that that his dad, Jeff, has gone through. They're playing in that Winnipeg Jets uniform, putting in the time as he lets us share the moment of being drafted.
Hey, grandma's proud of you, bud. I know. Buddy, I'll get to work hard.
Thank you. I'm so proud of you.
That is perspective. The first round of the National Hockey League draft, presented by Adidas in Chicago, continues. Buffalo and Detroit are next.
This program is brought to you by Golf Town, your destination for everything golf in Canada. Put away the sticks and dust off your clubs, because now we golf.
Who is child?
The future.
I need that girl.
I will do anything to protect her.
Apes! Together! Strong!
War for the Planet of the Apes.
Toyota is offering pre-collision system standard on virtually all models. Toyota Safety Sense, because we all deserve to arrive safely. Toyota is offering dynamic radar cruise control standard on most models. Toyota Safety Sense, because we all deserve to arrive safely.
Nothing is better than a Swiss Chalet quarter chicken dinner. Juicy, fresh, never frozen rotisserie chicken, golden fresh cut fries, and that famous Chalet sauce. But wait, two of them for just $14.99? I stand corrected. This offer is only here for 14 days until June 25th.
Introducing the limited edition Coors Light summer cans. Cold certified, sun activated. Coors Light is officially summer certified.
So the good news is I set up a very expensive state-of-the-art camera and finally found out who's been stunt driving all over the parking lot.
Lightning McQueen?
And his trainer, Cruz Ramirez.
And what's the bad news?
I used your credit card to buy the camera. Ooh, it's not supposed to do that.
Catch Disney Pixar's Cars 3 now in theaters and keep the fun going with great products from Canadian Tire.
Sportsnet Now, live stream sports. Visit snnow.ca for details.
7 picks into the opening round of the 2017 National Hockey League. First round of the draft. presented by Adidas. Darren Millard here on the panel, along with Sam Cosentino, Louis DeBrusque, Elliot Friedman is down on the draft floor, Jeff Merrick, as well as Tara Sloan handling our interviews. Vancouver has selected Elias Pettersson with the fifth overall pick. His dad ran the rink, so he had all kinds of bonus ice time. The Vegas Golden Knights have made their first selection. They'll be back at number 15, and then we get back to the Canadian side of things with Calgary at 16 and Toronto at 17. Up next is the Buffalo Sabres, who have gone through another makeover. They got Jack Eichel a couple of years ago. Tim Murray was the general manager, brought in the goaltender. It looked like things were trending in the right direction. Instead, they've done a reset, and Jason Bottrell is the general manager at the helm right now, about to make his first pick as a GM.
The Buffalo Sabres are pleased to select from Eden Prairie, Casey Mittelstadt.
This is an interesting pick because of decisions and then production from Casey Mittelstadt. Sam.
Following the path of Riley Tufte, who was selected 25th overall by the Dallas Stars last year, you had a guy who was born in Minnesota, and the Minnesota thing really plays heavy. So he wanted to go back, he wanted to continue to be a kid, wanted to be with his buddies, wanted to play in high school, but he also enabled himself the opportunity to go into the USHL and play there as well. And that's where scouts really had to hunker down and watch him to see him against higher level of competition. He said that playing in the USHL was actually a bit easier for him because he had better players and older players with which to play with. Whereas when he went and played in Eden Prairie, he was the guy, he was the focal point, the center of attention, who could show off all of his individual skills. I think there was some concern about this pick when you go back and look at how committed is he going to be. And it wasn't just the high school decision, but when we saw him at the combine and he struggled with the pull-up, struggled with the bench press.
Didn't just struggle, he didn't do any.
Yeah, well, that's a struggle.
Yeah.
We saw that happen to Sam Bennett as well, too. Now, there was something behind that with Sam Bennett. For Casey Mittelstadt, though, for me, one of the things I do like about him is he had the sense of mind to say, you know what, I'm going to stick around. I'm going to go back and play where I want to play. He didn't let the peer pressure get to him to go somewhere else. So I like that individuality in a player. I really do. The one thing also I like about him is he does finish. When he gets his opportunities, he puts the puck in the net. This is a project pick, I think, you know, for the Buffalo Sabres, where they obviously see an upside in him.
The fitness testing, that changed the opinion of by a couple of clubs.
Oh, I don't think there's any question about it. And it's funny because if you really don't like the player, you say, oh, he's not committed, his fitness testing wasn't any good. But if you like the player, you say, well, he's really has all of this room to grow in terms of his strength and his physical conditioning when he gets exposed to living the pro life. So that's what the Buffalo Sabres would say about this player. Hey, he hasn't really done any work yet. Wait till we get him into our fray with our strength and conditioning guys.
We'll get that opinion from the general manager who's with Elliot.
Jason, Sam Cosentino was just talking about now you're excited about the prospect of getting him working with your strength and conditioning guys. What do you see as the path for Casey now to the NHL?
Well, he'll go to the University of Minnesota. Great opportunity there to play with some good players, play with a lot of pace in college hockey, and then we'll see how the development path goes there. We'll be patient with him, but we're extremely excited about his skill level and his dynamic ability.
All right, so who was happier, Casey Mittelstadt getting drafted 8th overall today or Jason Botterill getting drafted 20th overall in 1994?
Well, let's hope that Casey plays a few more NHL hockey games than Jason Botterill did. Oh, loved the hair, too, back in the day. Really good.
Were you nervous at all making your first pick as a GM?
It's always nervous coming and being a part of the process here, but our staff did an amazing job getting the list together, and we were prepared for however it fell, but we're extremely excited to have Casey a part of our organization now.
Thank you, and congratulations, Jason.
Thank you very much, Elliot.
Tara?
Thank you, Elliot. Jason Botterill, very excited to have Casey Mittelstadt in his organization. Casey, your decision to go back and play high school was a risky one. Even your parents really weren't on board at first. Did you ever hesitate and think, I don't know if this is the right route?
I think maybe a little bit at first, especially when you first make the decision the spring before the year. But once the year started and once I got in with my buddies and my teammates, I really think it was the right decision. Looking back, I definitely have no regrets.
I know how much your teammates mean to you, but somebody who also meant a great deal to you, Steve Ollinger, an assistant coach with Eden Prairie. Talk about him a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, he passed away about a month ago now, and he was motivation for us every time. He came to the rink every day with a smile, always gave us hope and had a positive attitude. And obviously he passed away, but I definitely still think he won. And a couple of us got to go see him before, and he was in good spirits, so I think that helped us a little bit.
Well, I know he'd be proud. Casey, thank you very much. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Darren?
And Tara, Phil Housley, coming out of that high school system himself a few years ago, but knows about the pressure of making that transition when a Buffalo Sabre club is expecting big things from you.
No question. You know, I think this is a great pick. And obviously for Phil Housley, who I played with in Chicago, one of the greatest American players ever to play the game, sees a lot in the youngster. Going to college, University of Minnesota, he's going to bulk up. He's going to get stronger, play less games. The future is bright for him, and that's what they're hoping for.
Making the next selection, the Detroit Red Wings in a top 10 spot for the first time in years.
This is our first draft without our passionate owner, Mr. I. So on behalf of the Ilitch family, Ken Holland, the Detroit Red Wings are proud to select from the Tri-City Americans of the Western Hockey League, Michael Rasmussen.
Goals in 50 games as the Detroit Red Wings miss the playoffs for the first time in 25 years. They're back in this position and they go straight to some offensive talent.
Yeah, pretty neat. He reminds me a little bit of Anthony Mantha, the first round pick from a couple of years ago. A guy who has good size and a guy who has no problem sitting in front of the net and sitting there and waiting and picking up the dirty goals. There was some concern, and with his 55 points, 29 of them were counted for on the power play. So you have to wonder about that waiting. What's he going to be like in even strength situations? But if you do take a closer look, you'll see that a lot of his power play goals, 16 of them in front of the net, tips, deflections, dirty goals, the kind of stuff that happens in the National Hockey League. Now, get the puck to the net and then hopefully somebody with size and strength can bear down and bury it, and this guy can do that.
Yeah, you liken to Dave Andrechuk, and I love that similarity. Yeah. Because, you know, that's a guy that went to the net, stood in front of the net at 6'5", and that's exactly what I see Rasmussen doing, and that's where he plants himself. You have to have a skill set to do that. It's hand-eye coordination, it's quick hands in tight to get the puck into the net. For a big man, that's what he possesses, and for the Detroit Red Wings, they're looking for that strength up the middle of a guy that can potentially be that number one guy in the power play in front of the net.
There's always that theory that you're going to be so awkward at that age with that kind of height.
He's not.
No.
Yeah, that's impressive. You know, for 6'5" as a forward, too. You see some of the types of goals that he scores, and that's exactly what Sam is talking about. That is the NHL nowadays, with the way everybody collapses, get to the net, have that nose around that 10-foot area around the blue paint. And for Rasmussen, a lot of big guys don't necessarily have that finite skill and type. That's one of the things that he possesses.
Let's go to Buffalo, guys, and think about at the combine. When he walked into the room, this guy's Man Mountain. He shakes your hand, he looks you in the eyes, got all kinds of presence. In fact, when he was hurt, he goes into the Tri-City dressing room, challenges all the guys to be better. Pretty tough for a 17-year-old to do that on a veteran team, but Michael Rasmussen does have that leadership capability within him.
They say the prototypical big center. That takes the cake. Here's Tar.
Thank you very much, Darren. Well, a celebration in Surrey for you tonight. I want to ask about your roommate. You billet with Yusuf Alamaki and his family. What's it been like to share this process with him? Because he's here waiting for his name to be called.
Yeah, obviously he's up there waiting, you know, but it's been something special. I can't really put it into words, but, you know, we're so thankful to play for Tri-City, and, you know, I'm really thankful for this moment.
Along the way, you credit a lot of your success with the Okanagan Hockey Academy in Penticton. What did they do for you?
Yeah, I can't really describe that either. I think that was the biggest step in my hockey career so far. And, you know, I thank Dixon Ward, Mike Needham, Malcolm Cameron, you know, very much.
Well, Michael, congratulations to you. Darren?
Suffered a broken wrist this season. Did not play after that February 1st incident. But right now, everything's working in his favor. A top 10 pick as we continue from Chicago.
In a few moments, we're going to be making our final descent into Las Vegas, but this is no ordinary WestJet flight. Now please look out those left-hand windows in 3, 2, 1. Congratulations, seat number 4A. Yeah, you just got a WestJet VIP Vegas upgrade.
Eastside Mario's Italian Food Festival is here! My new entrees from $12.99, like chicken cacciatore or pepperoni panzerotti with all-you-can-eat soup or salad and garlic home loaf, only until June 25th. Dine in or order now.
Eastside Mario's. Having a boom, bada.
We're in Rosemeath, Ontario, with another OLG lottery winner, Carl, and his wife, Bev.
I says to Bev, I said, I think I won $12,000.
That's 12 million, she said.
What was the first thing you bought?
The first thing I bought was a lavender pillow and 12 pair of socks. I bought a big chunk of land to Northern Ontario. You know, you look after your own. This is a good way to do it and keep everybody happy.
For us, it's freedom and taking care of the family.
This summer, in the state that invented the American vacation, a legendary adventure awaits. Heroes will rise, bonds will be forged, and memories will be made to last a lifetime. New York State, it's all here. It's only here. Plan your summer trip at ilovenY.com.
Number 10 pick is up next at the first round of the 2017 NHL Draft here in Chicago on Sportsnet, presented by Adidas. Darren Millard, Sam Cosentino, Louis DeBrusque. The Florida Panthers are up. This is an interesting pick. Tell me where the direction of the franchise is going, because they kind of lost their way. General manager Dale Tallon admits that. They went all in on analytics and now have backed off a little bit. This 10th overall pick may tell you just exactly where they are in the entire process. Dale.
Right back at you. I'd like to wish Bill Torrey a happy birthday. 83 years old, his 50th NHL draft. Billy, happy birthday. And I'd like to say hi to all our fans at Boat Campers. The Florida Panthers are proud to select from the Mississauga Steelheads, Owen Tippett.
Owen Tippett, one of those eight players selected to sit behind the stage in the green room. Emotional moment for Dale Tallon, former Blackhawk broadcaster as well as general manager. He assembled a lot of the players that are part of this three-time Stanley Cup team. But the Florida Panthers, with the journey that they've been through, and talking about analytics and then the old school, what does the selection of Owen Tippett tell you where they are?
Well, I think it tells me they're going back to the old school, and they put the keys back in Dale Tallon's hand and said, hey, remember what you did in Chicago? You were pretty good over there in building a Stanley Cup winner there. Why don't you just take things over again and try and do that in Florida? And without a doubt, it's a wise decision. Now, how he had time to be able to see everybody would have been a challenge, but Jason Bukala is the head scout there. He would have had time to be able to see everybody, but it's tough when you're answering to either the analytics master or the old school master, and you flip in between. I think this is an awesome pick. And I talk about Owen Tippett, a guy who plays on the off wing and is a sniper extraordinaire. There is no one in this draft who has the size, the speed, and the shooting ability of this guy right here. You look back to the start of the year, one goal in his first six games. They're saying, hey, what's going on? You're supposed to be a snipe show. What's happening here? He sits down with head coach James Richmond. They look at tape for three straight days, knock down, drag him out sessions in the video. Hey, you need to align your shoulders better. You need to align your feet better. We got to get you going on the one-timer. If you're going to be an off-wing guy, you need to score goals for us. So after those three sessions, they finally got back into gameplay. He scored 15 goals in the next 11 games. And from that point in the season, it took off for Owen Tippett.
And Louis, you'd appreciate this. He also changed his curve mid-season, and that helped out.
You know what? There's no question. Watch this shot right here. This kid is a shooter extraordinaire. And I look back to last year's draft, Patrick Laine. Look what that shot has done for the Winnipeg Jets. No question. I believe the shot that Owen Tippett possesses will have that much of an impact on an NHL team. This is a 30-40 goal scorer early in his career for sure. That's the type of shot that he possesses. And as you said, James Richmond said he is a coachable guy and is aware that he needs to work on the rest of his game. All the tools, no question. The toolbox needs to get worked on, but it's there.
That's also a franchise that can challenge for a Memorial Cup title next year with the Mississauga Steelheads. If you're wondering where they are in their development, Tara, hiring Chris Pronger to be part of your management group tells me they're going old school.
They are definitely going old school. I was saying to Owen, red looks good on him. I saw you just a little bit earlier. You looked nervous, looking a lot more calm and relaxed now. How are you feeling?
Good. I mean, I had no real expectations coming into the day, but it's been a dream of mine to put an NHL jersey on, so I'm happy it finally came true.
Your hug with your mom was a little bit extra long. What did she say to you?
Not a whole lot. I mean, it just kind of doesn't have to be said much. I mean, it's kind of said what we've gone through and what we've overcome in the years in the past. So, I mean, it's something that I've been wanting to do for a while.
So. Well, the guys up there love you. Darren?
Self-taught when it comes to shooting the puck. And mom, Tracy, Owen says she keeps his mind where it needs to be. And he also went on to say, she's going to cry for sure. Well, and that's a great moment.
Did you see him? That's about as candid as we've seen him. He gets in the interview with us. He's really uptight. I've talked to him personally at the rink, really close to the vest. Now, he's had a difficult upbringing, too. And that lady right there, hugely responsible for moving part of the family into the greater Toronto area so that they could experience hockey at a higher level. In fact, had to leave his sister behind with the father until things got straightened out there. So to think where this guy has come from, the personal adversity that we always talk about, the one thing against him is he seems to show indifference without the puck. But I think he's a guy that at some point, given a little love, getting into a pro environment is really going to help him. As we look at Gabe Vilardi, who's still sitting there, a projected top 10 pick, still sitting there and talking to his buddies here.
Elliot with Dale Talon.
Dale, this draft is about the kids, but you've been in pro hockey now for almost 50 years. I could tell the reaction of the Chicago crowd. That meant a lot to you.
Well, pretty special. Real proud to be a Blackhawk, but I'm prouder to be a Florida Panther. So it was a great feeling.
What convinced you that Owen Tippett was the guy for you?
Well, I saw him play a lot. I saw him play early in the year. I saw him play in the middle of the season, and I saw him at the end. I like the fact that he can score in traffic, and he's got good hands, got a great release, and he likes to shoot. Most of our talent are passers and playmakers, Barkov, Huberdeau. So he's a shoot first, still can make the play, but I like the fact that he can score goals, and that's one thing we're lacking in our depth chart.
Thanks very much, Dale.
My pleasure. Great job. Nice suit.
Thanks, Darren.
The shot overshadows the fact that Owen Tippett can skate, too.
Oh, no question. No question. And you talk about a guy in the off wing. Once he starts to use the middle of the ice a little more, he's going to be extremely dangerous because now the double option, burn a guy wide, cut it into the middle, and use that off wing shot.
Let's get one thing straight. Every player, young player that is, has to learn how to be a professional player. I don't care how good you are. Yeah. No different for Owen Tippett. But the upside on this kid is really, really big.
LA Kings now at number 11. Rob Blake, Hall of Fame defenseman, now the general manager.
With the 11th section in the 2017 entry draft, the Los Angeles Kings select from the OHL Windsor Spitfires, Gabriel Vilardi.
Mark announces the pick, and this fell into their lap with Gabe Vilardi slipping down as far as he did.
Doesn't he fit right into their program, though? He's big, he can handle a puck, he can make a play, has a good release, and a real nice hockey sense. You know, for him, he's one of the guys you like because he has that smile on his face all the time. He loves the game of hockey, and that's what you like in young players. He has a passion for the game. The LA Kings, they've been excellent at picking guys that can play and know how to play their style. I think Gabriel Vilardi fits right into it.
Sam Cotentino standing by, but we'll bring in Jeff Merrick for more analysis of the Windsor Spitfire.
Yes, Darren, analysis with a goaltender turned analyst, Memorial Cup champion Michael DiPietro, teammate with Gabriel Vilardi for the first time in NHL draft history. A teammate is going to become an analyst. What can you tell us from your experience about Gabriel Vilardi?
He's a pro. That's the first word that comes to mind when you speak of Gabe. He's a guy who's pro on and off the ice. He's professional. He's humble. Also, he's a great work ethic. He has a ton of skills, so I'm just so happy for him.
Okay, he's going to the Los Angeles Kings. For anyone playing against Los Angeles, what's his go-to move? You face him in practice.
Oh, he loves to cut to the middle, and wherever he cuts, he loves to go short side. You know, he can find an area the size of a nickel and put it there. So I can't pump his tires too much, but definitely he's a special player.
Now, he's known to have a very specific routine, and he stays on the ice long. He stays in the room long. What can you tell us about that? How frustrating is that for you as a goaltender?
It's definitely frustrating, but you know, we find fun in it for sure. Whether it be a competition or breakaways in the, at the end of practice, when we find fun in there, in the gym, we work out together. It seems like we're always glued at the hip in the rink, and to be, you know, see him get drafted by an organization like Los Angeles is nothing but the best for him, and he's a great player.
Okay, you guys won the Memorial Cup together, right? We're watching this viz right now. You've got a tattoo on your ribs of the Memorial Cup. Gabe told me he's getting one on his collarbone. I think 15 of you guys are doing it. What was that moment like with Gabriel?
It was great. It was something that, you know, Gabe and I said that we wanted to do since the Lincoln camp. And, you know, no season goes the way you know you think you're going to go. And for that to share it with him, we won Team Ontario together. Now to win a Memorial Cup championship with him is something that Gabe and I will remember. And I'm not too convinced he'll get the tattoo. I'm not sure if he'll man up to it. So who knows?
Let's get to Tara Sloan with Gabe Vilardi.
There's a man there wiping tears from his eyes. What are you feeling right now? You're an LA King.
Yeah, it's amazing, honestly. I'm so excited to go to LA here and just get things started. I'm real excited. I'm looking forward to this summer, and there's no words right now.
No, can you try to process what it was? I mean, you won the Memorial Cup. Like this whole year leading up, ups and downs, and stress about this moment.
Yeah, it's been a long year, like I said, but it's worth it. It's an amazing feeling right now.
Now, do you remember this? Take a look at this piece of video.
Gabriel Vilardi, my secret recipe of the day to all you hockey players out there. And I will grab the finished steak and put it on the plate with the broccoli and the sweet potatoes. Eat well, train hard, smile with Gabriel Vilardi at the Kingston Junior Frontenacs. Thank you very much.
Do you remember that?
Yeah, I remember that.
How
I was
old
talking.
Were you?
I was I think I was 11. I was talking to Jeff. He said he had a good surprise for me here, so yeah, that's
well,
a funny clip.
We've got another surprise from the crowd. A good friend of yours, Michael DiPietro, with some questions for you. Take a listen here.
Oh,
okay,
no.
We have Michael from Amherstburg. You're on the line with Gabe Vilardi. Your question, sir.
Lardo, Mara and I were wondering if you were working on your shell game over the summer. You know, obviously you got to work on your skating a bit, but who knows about your shell game? You got to improve that so we don't beat you and embarrass you all the time.
Oh, I bring the PS4 with me everywhere, so he doesn't even know what he's talking about. I beat him every time. It's ridiculous that he brings this up right now. But I'm always working on my game. You know that, Mikey.
Well, Gabe, celebrate. I hope you guys get to celebrate together. Congratulations.
Thank
to you.
You very much.
Darren?
Oh, what a moment. Share that with a buddy, with a teammate. That's fantastic. LA Kings is also a team that's in transition. Rob Blake takes over. John Stevens is the head coach now. Mike Fluta, assistant general manager, got promoted. So they're changing their philosophy a little bit. They've dined out in the OHL, but they're changing their philosophy.
It's pretty interesting that I find that they were really drafting for their coach before in Daryl Sutter, and they wanted to play that big, heavy game, yet this is a guy who really fits that mold. From the dots down, there's probably no better player in this draft, and he's coachable. He loves to play the game. I remember being at a practice on March 1st. We were in there for a couple of games. He stayed late after practice. He was working on his one-timers from low to high, which is a skill that apparently is pretty tough to get. I wouldn't get it. You would. But they came back, Rocky Thompson and Trevor Letowski, and said, yeah, that guy picked it up in like five shots. It's unbelievable.
Carolina at number 12, Calgary and Toronto at 16 and 17. But here's Ron
Carolina
Francis.
Hurricanes are proud to select from the Czech Republic, Martin Nečas.
Guy that had some experience playing with men, also has leaned on the experience of players who have come over and played in the National Hockey League, Martin Erat as well. So he's been tutored, he's been molded. Yeah.
Another project for sure. He's another slight frame player, but what you love about him is the fact that he competes. And, you know, I look to another countryman in David Pastrnak with the Boston Bruins. You know, how he came over, he built up his frame a little bit, he could skate, he could shoot, and he competed on pucks. And that's one of the things that people liked about Nečas, is that he was a guy that competed on pucks and looks to score goals, has a real good release, and he's also a right-handed shot.
When you compare it to playing in the Finnish League or playing in the SHL, there's a lot more hostile environments in the Czech League, and while the level of play might not be quite as high. It was really important for scouts to get in and see him into some visiting barns, to see him in a hostile environment, how he's going to react when the crowd's fired up and they're taking runs at him, and it didn't seem to bother him whatsoever. He repelled a lot of that physical play, and a guy who was the captain of a team that won the Ivan Hlinka tournament, that's the summer under 18 tournament for the first time in that country's history, they won it. He was the captain of that team and a big reason as to why.
Played in the men's league, then was forced to skip their championship series to go to the under-18s, and his club team ended up winning the championship. He wasn't happy about that, but he's enjoying this moment. Drafted 12th overall to the Carolina Hurricanes. As the moms enjoy this moment, there's very little like it. That first hug always goes to mom here at the draft in Chicago.
Introducing the limited edition Coors Light Summer Cans. Cold certified, sun activated. Coors Light is officially summer certified.
Start with a craving for McCain's Super Fries. Apply a good sprinkling of, I love this stuff. Serve with Sriracha Mayo. Voila! Super Fries a la Girls Night. Let cravings be your guide.
Nothing is better than a Swiss Chalet quarter chicken dinner. Juicy, fresh, never frozen rotisserie chicken, golden fresh cut fries, and that famous Chalet sauce. But wait, two of them for just $14.99? I stand corrected. This offer is only here for 14 days until June 25th.
The best way to ensure you don't miss a thing in life is to keep moving forward.
Agent Gascoigne was killed last night. Did you know him?
Enough to say hello.
Everyone you get close to ends up dead.
This only ends one way.
Atomic Blonde.
Italian Food Festival is here! Nine new entrees on $12.99, like Chicken Cacciatore or Pepperoni Panzerotti, with all-you-can-eat soup or salad and garlic home loaf. Only until June 25th. Dine in or order now. Eastside Mario's. Having a boom and a...
It's Buck Martinez here, and Sleep Country's All-Star Sale is on now. Plus, until Sunday, you can hit it out of the park with this Hot Buy Eurotop Queen set for just $5.99. So get up and get out of here to Sleep Country. Sleep Country is the official provider of sleep of the Toronto Blue Jays.
Inching up in the midway mark of the 2017 first round of the National Hockey League Draft in Chicago. A couple of Canadian teams coming up. Calgary Flames and the Toronto Maple Leafs. Brian Burke discussing things with the general manager of the Toronto Maple Leafs, Lou Lamoriello. So that's at 16 and 17. We're currently at number 13 and the second pick of the night for the Vegas Golden Knights. George McPhee's had a long week of announcing draft picks from the expansion process Wednesday night in Las Vegas at the NHL Awards, and now the entry draft here. Earlier we saw them go with Cody Glass.
Vegas Golden Knights are pleased to select from Owen Sound Nick Suzuki.
Owen Sound in the Ontario Hockey League.
The Vegas Golden Knights, I think, were really lucky to be able to pick up Scott Luce and Aaron Janelle. Those guys formerly worked with Gerard Gallant in the Florida Panthers as their head scout director of scouting. And so when those guys got let go from the Florida Panthers, when they went in that analytics direction for a couple of minutes, the Las Vegas Golden Knights snuck in. They grabbed those guys, and with the experience of some of the players they've drafted, it was a home run for George McPhee. Now I'm looking at a guy in Nick Suzuki that plays in every situation, makes everybody around him better. The Owen Sound attack, a little diminutive in size, but this guy has got some kind of drive to his game. Really fascinating when watching him play. Before the game, they do the starting lineup, they're announcing it in the dressing room. And when his name gets announced, they say Nick McGill, as in head coach Ryan McGill, because he's so tightly tied with what the head coach and his messaging is, that he's become the leader of his hockey club, and he's done a marvelous job in Owen Sound. That's a really good pick there for Vegas at 13.
You know, rightfully so, Ryan McGill. Couldn't say enough great things about Nick Suzuki, and that is exactly the way he plays. The kid can just downright play in every situation, and he relied on him heavily. And that's exactly why he's being picked by the Vegas Knights.
And there's his good buddy, Isaac Ratcliffe. The two of them played together growing up with the London Junior Knights. Since age six, they're best of buddies. I'm sure they had a little side bet as to who was going to go first. Suzuki wins that one.
So when you have multiple picks, like the Vegas Golden Knights do, and three in the first 15, did you see a different type of game plan here in a different direction?
Well, definitely at 15, I can see him going with a defenseman or a goalie. I think you've got your two centerpieces in the middle of the ice with both Glass and Suzuki. Defenseman or goalie should be taken next at 15.
Tara Sloan.
Well, Nick, the guys upstairs were just talking about your relationship with head coach Ryan McGill. What has he done for you and your game?
He's definitely done a lot. He's helped me throughout the 2 years in Owen Sound and really kind of turned me into the player I am today. And I owe a lot to him and the growth of my hockey.
Also, I just saw a shot of Isaac Ratcliffe, your childhood friend with whom you played with the London Junior Knights. Did you guys have a side bet as to who was going to go first today?
No, we didn't. We're just happy to see where each other go and where that's going to be. It's going to be unbelievable, both of us getting picked in the NHL. And it was awesome when I did it in the OHL, and it's going to be awesome this time.
Well, congratulations to you, Nick.
Yeah, thank you.
Darren?
Ryan McGill, CHL Coach of the Year, won a Memorial Cup with the Kootenai Ice.
I look at this guy, and he plays on a line with two players. You talk about making players around you better. Jonah Gadjimik will likely go either late in the first or early tomorrow in round number two. Was a 46-goal scorer playing on a line with Suzuki. Then I look at a guy by the name of Kevin Hancock, who's in his second year of draft eligibility. I think he's got high potential to go as a later round guy when he was overlooked in his first year. A lot of that has to do with playing Suzuki and how successful he is at making those around him better.
Yeah, 45 goals and 51 assists. I mean, that just tells you a lot about the player. He's just as happy passing it off as putting it in the net himself, and possesses a very quick release.
That 13th selection was where Winnipeg was positioned to draft in this first round. They swapped picks and dropped back because of the expansion draft and the negotiations that took place there. But Nick Suzuki drafted 13th overall by the Vegas Golden Knights.
Thank you.
Vegas beat him.
Falls view.
Thanks, Dave.
Vegas baby. They'll be back in a couple of picks at 15. Also a pick that they acquired through the expansion draft from the New York Islanders. Tampa Bay Lightning, you thought all year they were going to be able to turn it around and eventually get in, but they fell short. Tampa Bay Lightning at 14, Vegas 15, then Calgary and Toronto at 16 and 17 as we get into the Canadian sides. Vancouver's the only Canadian team that has picked so far. Steve Yzerman traded Jonathan Drouin to the Montreal Canadiens, picked up Mikhail Sergachev, first-round pick a year ago. What direction might they be looking?
Well, fascinating for me. You think with the acquisition of Sergachev, who should be able to step into their lineup next year, that a defenseman might be off the board here for the Tampa Bay Lightning. But then again, it's such a position that has such a high profile, and there's so much emphasis on that position. We'll see what he does here.
Tampa's very pleased to select from Kelowna of the Western Hockey League, Cal Foote.
That's a long history between Steve Yzerman, the Detroit Red Wings when he played, and the Colorado Avalanche and Adam Foote, and it comes full circle with Yzerman drafting Foote's son.
I think it's perfect. You know what? Adam Foote was a beast to play against.
Time
he
heals.
Was nasty. He took you out, and Steve Yzerman had battles with him. And you know what? Cal Foote is a big kid. One of the things that stood out to me is his big quads. He's tall. This guy's going to fill out, and he has a little bit of that demeanor as well that his dad has. This is a nice pick for the Tampa Bay Lightning. He can really fill out and play into his body.
I think you really have to watch him closely, because the knock then, when I talked to some people about him, was that, oh, he's a little bit too soft, a little too passive. But he took 2 5-minute elbowing penalties this year, tried to sneak him in behind the play and out of the sight of the officials. It didn't quite work out. And I can remember a game we did in March against the Spokane Chiefs. It was a touch call to get a penalty. He back-footed it and fired it into the Spokane bench. Now, I don't know if there was purpose to it or not, but I know the end result was this. Don Nockbar, the head coach for Spokane at the time, got cut for 6 stitches, and he was some kind of hot because he felt it was a purpose pitch. So don't tell me that there's no bite in this guy's game. Look at the Kelowna Rockets, who they produce defensively, and how quickly those guys get to the National Hockey League, whether it's Luke Shen or Tyler Myers, his good friend Cole Lynn, also the Kelowna Rockets, waiting to get picked and watching his good buddy and really happy for him. But this is a defenseman producing factory. You have Jason Smith as the head coach there, a lengthy career, over 1,000 games in the NHL. Chris Millett, a very successful defenseman in his own right. They have done a marvelous job producing first-round picks. You go back to Lucas Johansson last year, taken by the Washington Capitals 28.
Where is he different? Where is he similar to his dad?
Well, I think the skating has to come a little ways, and that's been the big knock on this guy. But he's got size 16 feet. You try and skate with those things off, you'd end up on your face all the time.
You know what? Sorry.
Just some lower body strength and getting stronger should help propel him into better skating.
And you know what? Adam was a physical presence, no question about it. I battled against him in the Ontario Hockey League when he was with Sault Ste. Marie and I was with London. He was a disaster in front of the net. He played an abrasive style. But you forget, he could step up and make a play every once in a while, a real crucial time. And that's what I see in Cal Foote, is the fact that he knows when to jump in, he knows when to make that play, and has an offensive upside.
Cal's first memory, really, of his dad, 2004 World Cup in Toronto, when his dad won, is Ringan Elliott.
Steve, there are a lot of Red Wings and Avalanche fans who 20 years ago never would have imagined that Steve Yzerman would draft Adam Foote's son. What did you like about him?
Well, one, he's a big right-shot defenseman that can pass the puck. He has great hockey sense. It's a need we had. We felt some pretty good options with this pick, but it's a specific need that we had for our organization, and we're excited to fill that void.
Thanks very much, Steve. Congratulations.
My pleasure. Thanks, Elliot.
Darren?
Steve Yzerman watched a lot of the 19 years that Adam Foote played in the NHL. Now it's the second generation, one foot in front of the other, as we continue here at the National Hockey League Draft, the first round presented by Adidas on Sportsnet.
The 2017 NHL Draft, presented by Adidas.
Eastside Mario's Italian Food Festival is here!
My new entrees from $12.99, like chicken cacciatore or pepperoni panzerotti with all-you-can-eat super salad and garlic home loaf, only until June 25th. Dine in or order now. Eastside Mario's, having a boom, bada.
We don't have the money. She can't go to college.
Let's start an illegal casino.
Yeah!
Your mother and I will be working late.
I just can't help but feel like you're lying.
We love you so much, but you need to shut up.
What did you just say?
It's so hard being a parent.
The House, June 30th.
I see your true colors shining through. I see your true colors. That's why I love you. Don't be afraid to let them show your true colors. True.
Central signing season, July 1st, 11 a.m. on Sportsnet.
About to enter a stretch of 6 Canadian selections inside a 10-pick span. But first, it's the Vegas Golden Knights with their third selection of the night. at number 15. George McPhee has been busy, and this is one of those ones where you have so many picks in a short little span that you can take the odd risk and go off the board.
Yeah, I think a defenseman and a goalie has to be at hand. When you talk about drafting two centers already, getting Glass at six and moving with their 13th pick to get Nick Suzuki, you'd have to think that Gerard Gallant.
The Vegas Golden Knights are pleased to select from Sweden Erik Brännström.
George isn't even waiting around anymore. Right to business.
He's becoming Tim Murray.
It's old news for him.
They've been working long and hard at this, that's for sure.
So there's three picks. If Cody Glass went six, Portland Winterhawks to the Vegas Golden Knights. Nick Suzuki out of Owen Sound at 13. And now Erik Brännström, defenseman, at 15.
Well, a dynamic puck mover and an excellent skater. There's one thing that has to be cautioned against when taking this pick. If you look at regular defensemen in the National Hockey League this year, there were only two of them that were regulars in the NHL that played under 180 pounds. Brännström is under that mark right now. The two guys that played, Chris Russell and Jared Spurgeon. The only two regulars in the National Hockey League. Think about that for a minute. 30 teams, seven defensemen on a team. That's 210 guys, and only two of them played at under 180 pounds. So you have to look at him and say, is he going to be able to put on size? Is he going to be able to put on strength? Is he going to be able to get up over that 180-pound mark? But there is no question about the dynamic ability in this guy's game, and we've talked a lot about it throughout the course of the night. Puck-moving defenseman, offensive defenseman, a guy who can run a power play, this guy checks all those boxes.
Loves to control the puck, and that's the key with him. That's the new NHL, as we've talked about. It's speed, it's control, it's passing. He has all those ingredients.
30 selections on Wednesday night, three more in the entry draft tonight. General Manager George McPhee, Assistant GM Kelly McCrimmon, Director of Player Personnel Bob Lowe's. What a week it's been. Up next, Calgary and Toronto as the first round continues on Sportsnet.
Closed captioning brought to you by Canada Post. Delivering more parcels to Canadians than anyone. Canada Post, delivering the online world.
How do I explain it? It was exhilarating, nimble, responding to my every touch. Moving faster than the wind. That feeling of pure driving. It was amazing.
The 2017 Lexus IS.
Nothing is better than a Swiss Chalet quarter chicken dinner. Juicy, fresh, never frozen rotisserie chicken, golden fresh cut fries, and that famous Chalet sauce. But wait, two of them for just $14.99? I stand corrected. This offer is only here for 14 days until June 25th.
Are we ready? Sorry, I'm kind of new to this. So I guess this is the part where we talk about the beer?
Brewing beer that's this good took a serious pair of oranges. Nailed it.
The NBA Awards, Monday on Sportsnet 1.
National Hockey League first round of Friday night here in Chicago, presented by Adidas. Rounds 2 through 7 will be held tomorrow. Continuing coverage starts at 10 a.m. Chris Johnson, senior NHL writer on Sportsnet, will be part of our Saturday coverage. Nolan Patrick wearing that orange of the Philadelphia Flyers. Brandon Wheatking taken second overall by former Brandon Wheatking goaltender Ron Hextall. Darren Millard here on the panel along with Sam Cosentino from the Canadian Hockey League on Sportsnet and Louis DeBrusque from Hockey Night in Canada. The Calgary Flames start this stretch of Canadian teams at number 16. It's the first time since 1986 that the Calgary Flames will draft in this position. That year, they selected George Palawa, who was Mr. Hockey in Minnesota. He was 6'3", 245 pounds, and he was just a force in front of the net. He was a state finalist for top linebacker. He was also a great basketball player. He chose hockey. 3 months after he was drafted, 16th overall by the Calgary Flames, George passed away as a result of a car accident, wasn't wearing his seatbelt. But I talked to the man that drafted him in Cliff Fletcher and said he watched him work out once at a USA Hockey event, and everybody just bounced off him. And Cliff said, that's the key. 1986, that's the key and my path to beat the Edmonton Oilers. and get out of Alberta. George Palawa never did play a game in the NHL, but the Calgary Flames continue to this year to contribute to a scholarship fund in George's memory in Bemidji. Calgary Flames at 16 with their first pick of the draft. Brad Treliving.
Calgary Flames are proud to select from Tri-City of the Western Hockey League, Juuso Välimäki.
Big hugs from mom, and why not? She uprooted her family to move to Tri-City to take care of her son, to make sure that he was going to be fed properly, to make sure that he was going to be taken care of. And in fact, when they went over there and got their residence, they asked Michael Rasmussen to come in and be their billet. So the two guys live together with the Tri-City Americans. They play off each other extremely well because Michael Rasmussen is Captain Serious. He's a guy that's tough to crack a smile from. In fact, some say, hey, you got to be a kid once in a while and have some fun. Where Välimäki is that fun-loving guy who likes to have a good time, who can lighten the mood. I think it's an absolute perfect fit for those two. When you talk about maybe needing to be a bit more serious, the cup holder there in Välimäki could use some of Rasmussen. And when Rasmussen can use a little more lightening up, he can turn to Välimäki.
Well, you look at the last seven first-round picks of the Calgary Flames have all been forwards, so now they go out and take a defenseman, and they needed a puck-moving defenseman. They needed to rebuild that cupboard, restock it, and that's what they get in Välimäki. He's a real solid performer. You know, he doesn't necessarily dazzle you, but he plays the right way, and he can get into the offense, and that's the one thing you like about him. He plays defense first, but then he gets up in the offense and can make a play, and that's the type of defenseman you want to have.
It's really interesting because you go back to the start of the year, and the Tri-City Americans weren't sure exactly what they were going to have, whether they were going to be an offensive team or not. Well, Mike Williamson, the head coach, said, we're worried about getting offense. So he turned things over to Välimäki and said, you know what? We're allowed to take some risks here. We want you jumping up on the play. And that was so huge for the development of this player who comes into the season saying, hey, I got the green light here to do things. Now, you can't go crazy. But given that license to be able to go on the offensive, Välimäki was able to put up 61 points in 60 games. Really impressive for a defenseman in the WHL.
5 years ago, he was on his way to buy new skates. He found out that he didn't make the All-Star team of 13-year-olds. And he was crushed. He told his parents, I don't even want the skates. And they bought them anyway, and they went through it. The next year, with those new skates, he was the best defenseman in the country at the 14-year-old level. Rantaro.
Thank you very much. So we're looking at pictures of your mom, and she's absolutely losing her mind. She uprooted, she and your brothers, to come be with you in Tri-City. What's your sense of gratitude towards them right now?
No, I'm just so happy to have them with me and here and in Tri-City, and all the support what they have gave me over these years and all the help. So I'm just so happy to have them in my life.
I know you and Michael Rasmussen have been inseparable. He's your billet mate. He's your best friend. What's it like to share this night now, both of you being drafted in the first round?
Oh, it's awesome. It was awesome to have him there in the same boat for the whole year and go through this process together. And now tonight we're going to enjoy this together.
You can both breathe a collective sigh of relief. Congratulations.
Thank
to you.
You.
Darren Elliott.
Tara, Brad Treliving just said that the importance of a player to be able to play both sides in today's day and age. Was that one of the reasons you targeted him?
Well, it's one of the things. We really like the player here. He came, obviously, came over, put up a lot of points in the Western Hockey League. He's versatile. He's competitive. We really like his brain, too. He can think the game, and to play this position nowadays, you got to be able to think, be able to move a puck, and ultra-competitive, so we're ecstatic.
It was a crazy morning. Have you been surprised at how quiet tonight's been?
Well, not so much yet. We'll see how the rest of it goes, but it started off with a bang tonight. We'll see how the rest of the night goes.
All right, we're counting on you. Thanks very much, Brad.
Thanks, Elliot.
Darren?
Elliot, not the path out of Alberta anymore as we complete the story on George Palawa, but there is history to this pick.
Yeah, no question. I mean, you look at what Välimäki has done, and you look at the historical sense when you talk about Miro Heiskanen, two Finnish defensemen taken in the first round. It's funny, you go all the way back to 7 years ago. We talked to Jarmo Kekäläinen last year, and he said one thing that the Finnish program did was hire high-end coaches for their younger players. That really helped develop the skill side of things, and what we're seeing in the under-18s, in the under-20s with the Finns is unbelievable. This might be unprecedented, a draft for the country of Finland.
Lou Lamoriello and the Toronto Maple Leafs making their way to the podium. pick number 17. Long way from Austin Matthews and number one a year ago, which tells you really what kind of year they had. Average position of their selections the last five drafts has been at number 8. So to be at 17 signifies a great progress as Nylander, Marner, Matthews, Gauthier, and Riley, their top past five first selections, have all played in the National Hockey League already.
Yeah, it's pretty neat. And being forwards, a lot of success there.
Toronto's selection of this year's draft will be made by assistant general manager and director of scouting, Mark Hunter.
Toronto proud to announce from Sweden, Timothy Lindgren.
Another defenseman. That's four Swedes now in the first round, which ties the record. But this is a player, defenseman, who had trouble finding his place in this year. He was at the very top with Nolan Patrick at the start of the year.
It's crazy where things have gone for this guy. And I can't help but think of Oliver Shillington, who was taken by the Calgary Flames a couple of years ago, who went 60th overall. If you go back to Shillington's 16-year-old year, it was the same as Liljegren. They were unbelievable. Great skaters, good puck movers, and guys who you thought were going to be in the top five of their respective National Hockey League drafts. Well, for Shillington, things went downhill playing in Far Eastead. He, in fact, couldn't stay at the highest level in the SHL. So he got sent down. And the same thing for Liljegren. He started the year with mono and then had trouble finding his place, finding a team, didn't get back healthy enough in time to be able to play for Sweden's World Junior team. So bouncing around really hurt this guy. And he said to us he didn't really feel like the player that he was until about January. But you can't help but think, you go back to a 16-year-old, the projection was for him to be a top five pick in this draft. It doesn't work out, but he still stays in the first round and a great place for Toronto, who could use defense.
You see the new look of the Adidas uniforms with that patch on the shoulder for the Toronto Maple Leafs. So where he was at the start of the year, how comfortable are you putting the word steal into what was is now the 17th pick?
I believe he is a steal, and I'll tell you why. His first two steps are amazing. And, you know, when you look at him, the way he skates, he likens his game to Erik Karlsson. That's a guy he looks up to, Drew Doughty. Watch his strides. He's smooth. He's powerful. And that's what we saw all playoffs long with Erik Karlsson, was the way he moved his feet and was able to gain ice and get into position. I see Liljegren growing into it. He's a fantastic skater. That's the defensive game nowadays.
The walk-up song when we talked to him at the
yeah,
at the draft combine, Fort Minor, remember the name. And that's what he wanted, because he felt like he let an opportunity slip past him. Tara.
Thank you very much, Darren. Timothy, you said you thought your mom would be very emotional at this moment, and you owe her a great debt of gratitude because she's been very supportive this year. What has she done for you?
She's been terrific, you know. She supported me when I moved to Rögle Ängelholm, you know. She raised three sons by her own, so she's been amazing.
I'm sure you know that Toronto is an avid hockey market. For fans out there, what kind of player can they expect from you?
I'm an offensive defenseman. I like to skate with the puck, you know, be in the offensive zone and create points.
Well, Timothy, congratulations to you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Elliot.
Assistant General Manager Mark Hunter. And Mark, they were talking about how high he was regarded at the beginning of the year. Do you reach a point where you say, if he falls to us, we're not considering anything else?
Exactly. I mean, he's a talented young man, and when he fell that far, it was a no-brainer.
From what you saw of him this year, did you see a reason as to why maybe he dropped?
Well, he had mono for 8 weeks. He was out for a long period of time, and anybody that had mono, knows how much it takes out of your body. So he, when he got back going again, it took some time, but he's an elite talent, elite skater, and can move pucks, and Toronto Maple Leaf fans will really enjoy him.
What's your plan for him?
You know what, we'll bring him to camp and see how he does, and you know, play day by day.
Thanks very much, Mark.
Yeah.
Darren?
Well, we know that they're not against putting kids into the lineup. Mike Babcock went up and spoke to mom, Mona, as he always does with the selections that the Toronto Maple Leafs make. leaves everybody else to go up to the podium.
Does this look any different than the forwards that Mark Hunter has taken? When you talk about Nylander, you talk about Marner. One thing that Mark Hunter always did, even going back to his days in London, he wants skilled players that make plays. It sounds really simplistic, but this is exactly what he is. Instead of being a forward, he's a defenseman, a skilled player who makes plays. And it's someone that really the Toronto Maple Leafs don't have. A little bit in Jake Gardner, a little bit in Morgan Rielly, but not quite to the extent of what Liljegren would project to be a couple of years down the road.
He doesn't. Like, he's not a project, though.
No, you know what? I like this player. You know, anytime that you watch him skate and the way he plays, very mature in his game, no question the Mono put him back. And I think that's probably the thing that made him slip to where he was. But you heard what Mark Hunter said. If he's there, I'm going to grab him. And that's exactly what they did. They had this player in mind. They didn't take any time. They just took him.
So this philosophy that Mark Hunter has in place with the Toronto Maple Leafs continues as they go a skill. And, you know, he admitted he came back too fast from Mono, because he felt the pressure of his draft ranking, and that was hanging over his head. Here's the Boston Bruins at number 18. There's a great story, by the way, between the Boston Bruins and a connection with Nolan Patrick that occurred at the draft combine that we'll get to after they make the pick at 18.
The Boston Bruins are proud to select from JYP Finnish Elite League Urho Vakanainen.
Five first-round picks in the last 3 years, and Vakanainen was one of those guys who really benefited from playing with Miro Heiskanen. The two paired together for Finland at the World Under 18, so every time you wanted to go see Heiskanen, you couldn't help but notice the guy playing beside him. What made Heiskanen so successful and allowed him to score 12 points to be the top defenseman in that tournament was this guy standing home and taking care of business. So you're not likely to get huge offensive upside with this player, but what you are going to get is a guy who can really take care of business in his own end of the rink and every now and then chip in with some offense. Vakanainen, that I think was projected to go a little bit lower, but when you fall in love with a guy and you see the opportunity, you got to jump, and Don Sweeney did that.
You know, and Don Sweeney has not been afraid to jump up and take a player that he feels is a player that he can fill a situation with. And when you look at it, this is the staple type of defenseman you want to have in your organization. As you said, that stay-at-home guy that makes the right plays, is solid in the defensive zone. I mean, you have to have those bodies, you have to have those players, and the Boston Bruins feel he's the one.
Don Sweeney going up and making the pick, that's got to bring you back memories, Louis. Yeah. Jake DeBrusk, your son, who went. But Sweeney showed his personality at the draft combine.
Oh, yeah.
Because they interviewed Nolan Patrick, who was ranked number one, slipped to two here at the draft. And before they brought Nolan Patrick in for the meeting, for the interview, Sweeney grabbed him and said, I don't care what the first question is, you say, you guys are drafting 18th. What are you gonna? You're gonna move up to get me? Why am I here? It's Patrick's thinking. Okay, goes in, and this gives you an idea of just where Nolan Patrick is in the grand scheme of things, in his confidence. Because some guys would just, I'm not going that down that. First question comes, and he says, "What am I here? Are you gonna trade up to get me?" Dead stare.
Everybody.
And there
quiet.
Was there was a pause there. Yeah, and
perfect.
Sweeney was the first one that started laughing, and then Patrick broke out. But the Boston Bruins having some fun, just putting a bit of humility to it. It's, we work our way towards the next Canadian team that's going to pick Edmonton at 22. But up next, it's San Jose at 19.
Nothing is better than a Swiss Chalet quarter chicken dinner. Juicy, fresh, never frozen rotisserie chicken, golden fresh cut fries, and that famous Chalet sauce. But wait, two of them for just $14.99? I stand corrected. This offer is only here for 14 days until June 25th.
The average family's hectic home. It's raised one daredevil, two dynamic DIY duos, and an entrepreneur named Sharon. It's witnessed 31 crashes, four food fights, and the flood of 09. It's your paradise perfected with Behr Premium Plus low odor interior paint, voted Canada's most trusted brand. Award-winning results, heroic price. Right now, get great savings on Behr paints and stains. Only at the Home Depot.
We're in Roseneath, Ontario, with another OLG lottery winner, Carl, and his wife, Bev.
I says to Bev, I said, I think I won $12,000.
That's $12 million, she said.
What was the first thing you bought?
The first thing I bought was a lavender pillow and 12 pair of socks. I bought a big chunk of land to northern Ontario. You know, you look after your own. This is a good way to do it and keep everybody happy.
For us, it's freedom and taking care of the family.
approaching the 19th selection of this first round of the NHL draft in Chicago, presented by Adidas. Sportsnet's coverage continues. Darren Millard, Sam Cosentino, Louis DeBrusque, and on the draft floor is Jeff Merrick. Are you surprised at all at the volatility that we're starting to see in the bouncing around of these picks?
Yes, certainly. And Darren, there's a couple of players which I'm a little bit surprised haven't been selected yet, but now with San Jose on the board, Edmonton on the horizon as well. You wonder if a player like Kyler Yamamoto from the Spokane Chiefs, he's smallish, but he's speedy. The analytics guys love him. He puts up big numbers, not only on the special teams, but on five-on-five as well. You wonder if Yamamoto could be someone that Edmonton's looking at. They have enough size up front. They want skill. And Christian Vesalainen, big power forward from Finland. This is the year of the Finn. Didn't work out with Frölunda at the beginning of the season. Ripped the organization on his way out. But then at the U18, put up 13 points and was the dominant player in that marquee event. We'll see what happens with Yamamoto and Vesalainen still to come, Darren.
Jeff, the first Canadian selection made tonight, Elias Pettersson at number 5. Yusuf Välimäki went 16 to the Calgary Flames, followed by Timothy Liljegren to Toronto at 17. Next Canadian club is Edmonton at 22, Winnipeg at 24, Montreal at 25, and Ottawa at 28. Right now, it's San Jose with that 19th overall selection. Doug Wilson making his way to the stage. San Jose Sharks have 3 in the back end of this draft, and at number 20, you're almost like stuck in the middle. 20 is that in-between stage as we go for the 19th pick.
We'd like to say hello to our fans back at Stanley's in San Jose. The Sharks would like to select from the U.S. program Josh Norris.
Surprised? This is a guy I had going at 26, but when you talk to scouts, he was one of the fastest risers. We've looked at Cody Glass as being a high riser. Now this is the guy that I think was next on that list of high risers, and it didn't start at the start of the year like it did for a Nico Hischier or like it did for a Cody Glass. It really started in the second half of the year. Norris was the best player on what was a down year in the U.S. under 18 program, but he was consistent throughout the course of the year. A team got off to a bad start, but in the second half they started to pick things up, they started to play better, and then he rolled into the under-18s, played extremely well there, and what cemented it for this guy was going to the combine and knocking it out of the park. The son of former National Hockey Leaguer Dwayne Norris, this guy grew up in Germany, stayed there for 11 years, and with that U.S. program, a really good second half and under-18, an excellent combine, bolted him right up into the 20s.
We talk about the combine and the fact that sometimes it might not have that much of an effect where players go. I don't believe that's the case here. Joshua Norris goes there, and as you mentioned, just absolutely dominated in certain skill sets. Terrific showing for him, and I believe that made people think, wait a second, this kid's got something. He's got to compete. He's got a willpower. He's going to work on his game relentlessly. He's a second generational player. He knows what it takes. There's a focus there, and this is a good pick by San Jose and a player that has an upside.
He's a coach's player, not super high end, but he'll play. Still 19th overall for a player that in the final North American rankings was 34.
Yeah, so it is a bit of a jump, no question about it. But I'm going to go back to San Jose here for a second. And I look at their last 5 drafts, they've produced 166 National Hockey League games. 55 of those came from Kevin LeBanc. So they've been spoiled with Pavelski and Marlowe and Thornton and Vlasic and Burns more recently. It's now time for some of those prospects where those holes are going to start to open up a little bit. And guys that have been suppressed in the American Hockey League and most recent picks are going to start to get the opportunity in San Jose, either due to retirement or salary cap restrictions, whatever the case may be.
He said his walk-up song would be Taylor Swift's You Belong to Me. That's what the San Jose Sharks are singing right now as Josh Norris goes at number 19. St. Louis is next. We're still waiting for Edmonton, Winnipeg, and Montreal at 22, 24, and 25. Kevin Cheveldayoff ready. They move down in this draft as it continues from Chicago, presented by Adidas on Sportsnet.
How would you sum up this car in one word?
Swanky.
Sexy.
Sexy.
Luxurious.
Classy.
Fast. Sporty.
Sharp.
Innovative.
Sleek luxury sedan.
Okay, that's more than one word.
This is the 2017 Chevy Malibu.
That's impressive.
Where's the local dealer around here?
Visit your Chevrolet dealer and take advantage of 0% purchase financing for 72 months on most 2017 Malibu models.
Schick Hydro. Protecting mankind, one face at a time. Schick Hydro. Technology that transforms.
Everything in human history has led to this very moment.
We're going down!
The final chapter begins. Whoa! Transformers: The Last Night.
It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter where you're from. It doesn't matter who you love. It doesn't matter if you belong to a union. It doesn't matter how much you make. It doesn't matter where you worship. You have a home in the Progressive Conservative Party of Ontario.
If it wasn't for heartbreak, missteps, mistakes, and missed opportunities, the unmet expectations, if it weren't for the oh-so-closes, maybe next times. Winning wouldn't feel like this.
Eastside Mario's Italian Food Festival is here! My new entrees from $12.99, like chicken cacciatore or pepperoni panzerotti, with all-you-can-eat soup or salad and garlic home loaf. Only until June 25th. Dine in or order now. Eastside Mario's. Having a boom, bada.
Hat wall in the green room as we put a lid on the top 20 selections of this first round of the 2017 NHL Draft, presented by Adidas here on Sportsnet. Darren Millard, Sam Cosentino, Louis DeBrusque, the St. Louis Blues with this selection. Doug Armstrong thought he might take a step back last year, and they went through the process of having to change coaches. Ended up having a pretty good playoff run from where they were mid-season. And now it's just a process of taking the pick, taking the second pick that they acquired from the Washington Capitals in exchange for Kevin Shattenkirk. So two in the final stretch, a third of this National Hockey League draft, and hitting a bit of a reset button for this organization.
St. Louis Blues are proud to select from the OHL London Knights, Robert Thomas.
Rob Thomas, Aurora, Ontario, born and raised, London Knights with that organization, won a Memorial Cup 1 year ago when the London Knights and Mitch Marner ripped through that tournament. This is a guy that got so much out of playing for that team and watching Dvorak and Marner and make that jump, and Tkachuk make the jump to the National Hockey League.
Yeah, when you're exposed to players like that, it definitely wants you, it helps you to elevate your game. So looking at Robert Thomas and playing on that team, no high leverage minutes for him, just simply checked in on the third line, and I think that helped him because he doesn't rely on for offense, so he could play for Dale Hunter in more of a defensive role, in a two-way role, win some face-offs for you in the third line, and benefit from getting matchups against third line players that were a little weaker than he was. Then he comes into this year and he's like, all right, I'm going to be one of the top offensive guys. Well, he didn't quite get all the high leverage minutes, but he started to get more minutes. And it's the typical London Knights curve that you see, where a young guy comes in, starts to get a little buzz, then he starts to get the ball rolling a little bit, learns to play 5-on-5 in his own end. And once you have that part of the game figured out, Dale Hunter says, all right, go nuts now. When you have the puck, do whatever you want with it. Just make sure that you're tracking back to get it when you don't have it, and make sure you're taking care of business in your own end. But once you get it, that's the fun part. There's the incentive. Get the puck back, do whatever you want with it. And I think Rob Thomas, you look at him and you say the numbers might be down a little bit, right about a point per game for the London Knights. But he brings so much more to the table than that. Everyone thinks that this guy's the next coming of Bo Horvat.
200-foot game. That's what it's all about for centermen nowadays, and that's where I think Robert Thomas fits in. And for St. Louis, they need that center position filled, and he fits that bill in a couple of years.
Robert Thomas hoping he can follow in the footsteps of the likes of Tkachuk, Dvorak, and Marner. Tara?
Rob, lots of pressure in your draft year, but you had Matthew Tkachuk to lean on. What advice did he give you?
Yeah, he gave me a lot of great advice. He sort of helped me through the whole process, and obviously he had such a great year in Calgary, so it was nice to sort of have a mentor like that. And there, you know, there's a lot of guys that went through it last year, so it was a lot of fun.
And you really upped your physical game by training with Gary Roberts.
Yeah.
What's that been like?
He's crazy. He's one of the best, and yeah, I'm lucky to be able to train with him and, you know, train along a lot of great guys. So yeah, it's really fun there, and I enjoy it.
Rob, congratulations to you.
Thank you very much.
Darren?
Not only lived and trained with Matthew Tkachuk a year ago, he spent a lot of time watching video of Tkachuk about the power part of the game. A little odd considering he was your teammate a year ago. Now you're watching him and getting tips in the video room. 11 picks remain in this first round, including 4 from the Canadian side of the border. From here in Chicago on Sportsnet, presented by Adidas.
Bumped. No, you didn't.
I should own an airline.
I'd be an incredible airline owner. And the first thing I would do is put an end over booking.
Sorry.
Bumped.
What do they even call it, bumped?
Trying to make it sound fun, like, ooh, you've been bumped.
How is it they sold my seat twice and now I can't get to my meeting, even though I paid for that seat?
What do you do? Call the airline? They're the ones who bump me. Call my boss?
I need to get another call from my boss.
I can't get another call from my boss.
Oh, you had a boss like that too?
Yeah. If I owned an airline, I'd make sure everyone gets the seat they paid for.
Actually, at WestJet, we don't overbook our flights.
Really?
Never mind.
It's just one of the ways we do business differently.
Thanks. Now, if only you could get me a flight.
Let's see what I can do.
No way.
Nothing is better than a Swiss Chalet quarter chicken dinner. Juicy, fresh, never frozen rotisserie chicken, golden, fresh cut fries, and that famous Chalet sauce. But wait, 2 of them for just $14.99? I stand corrected. This offer is only here for 14 days until June 25th.
At the stage where we're looking at teams that made playoff runs in the Stanley Cup postseason, pick number 21 with the New York Rangers. And yeah, they live and they die by what's going on in those playoffs. And then you got to turn that switch and look towards the future, as Jimmy Rutherford puts a cap on it with the Stanley Cup. Here's Elliot Friedman on the floor. It started with a bang, Elliot, today with all these trades, and now there's been nothing. We'll get to Elliot in just a moment. The New York Rangers have this 21st pick, second of the night.
Select from Zelin in the Czech Elite League, Filip Hedl.
Hedl. Still a surprise.
Yeah, no question. I think he was ranked in that 35 area by most prognosticators, but he did start to get some late love, and I think that had a lot to do with the under 18. So when it comes to Hedl, you go back to the summertime, you think about the Ivan Hlinka tournament, again, part of that Czech team that won gold. Look at his size here. There's obviously room for this guy to pack some pounds onto a frame, but it looks like he's got that hockey player's lower body. And this guy's got excellent hands, he's got good speed, and a guy who can be a difference maker. And it's funny, you talk about guys that get that late love and how important that under 18 tournament is in April, the World Championships. A big showing there for this guy allowed him to be picked 21st. But I think a surprise in that you see a guy that's probably ranked in the 30s and slips and bolts himself all the way up into 21.
Another European
11th
player,
in the European scouting department for his ranking. The New York Rangers keeping us on our toes today with the earlier moves that they made with the Arizona Coyotes. Elliot, but there's been no trades tonight.
You know, Darren, I think that's what we're all kind of stunned about. It's just that how quiet it's been. And not only, you know, we were buzzing so much before it began tonight with the shots we showed of the lengthy conversation between Gar Snow and Lou Lamoriello. There was Mark Bergevin with both Bob Murray and Chuck Fletcher, Don Sweeney and Chuck Fletcher. You know, we were sitting here thinking this is going to be a crazy night, and it's been very quiet, and at this point in time there's no real sense that it's getting any busier. Joe Sakic, after Colorado made the 4th overall pick, I asked him, do you think you're going to be doing anything tonight? And as he says right now, there's nothing going on. So I think that's one of the bigger surprises tonight, as opposed to any of the draft picks, Darren, is just how little trade action there's been around it after a bombshell morning.
There's so many teams with multiple picks as well in this first round. You thought they might be able to package one of those off. into a deal. But the New York Rangers have made their second selection of the first round, and now it's the Edmonton Oilers, who are a team that's used to picking a lot higher than that. Wayne, now involved officially with the Edmonton Oilers. Peter Chiarelli made the trade yesterday with the New York Islanders, so bringing in Ryan Strome. There's Harrison Cates. Got a great little piece on Harrison in just a minute. But the Edmonton Oilers and where they're looking at 22.
It's going to be fascinating to see what they do, because I think it's a team now that feels it's on the right track. It feels like it's got enough size to protect some of its smaller players and younger players, most notably Connor McDavid, of course, Lucic taking care of that. Darnell Nurse can be that guy. Not that the game's gone that way, but you still want your smallish younger players to be feel comfortable out there on this, to allow them to do their thing. But there are a couple of different options here. When you look at Christian Vesalainen, he does add some size, some two-way ability. You look at Kyler Yamamoto, he's a guy with a lot of skill in being smaller.
These drafts and these top picks that the Edmonton Oilers have had have allowed us to watch Harrison Cates, Daryl's, the owner's son, really grow up. And you look at this, as he grew in size, and Darnell Nurse is 6'4", and then you see him jump up to 6'1", and he's taller than Connor McDavid when he was drafted 2 years ago. 6'3", and Jesse Puljujarvi. So from a little kid standing there, taking it all in, just
a giant,
to now he's bigger than the players.
They've had to wait a little bit longer to get to the floor this time. This is the first time in 9 years they've drafted above 10, so that's good things for the Edmonton Oilers.
He was getting older and started to cut down that lid, but he looks like he's letting the flow go again.
This is the point of this draft, though, where it can go in another different directions, where you could go 50 deep in the rankings because there's that much parity in these picks.
Well, no question about it. And I think when we talk about this draft in an entirety, you're talking about middling players. You're talking about guys that should have decent length in terms of their NHL career, but guys who probably are going to fit in your middle six. So you're not going to see that high end like we've seen with Matthews or McDavid or Eichel or Laine. But what you're going to see is a lot of second and third line guys. And the way the NHL has gone, you look at Pittsburgh, three lines worth of depth over their last two cup wins. It's starting to be more important now to add scoring and add more dynamic ability to your third line.
Absolutely. And you know what? They've liked this Kyler Yamamoto out of the WHL, and they've talked about him at length in Edmonton, where I live. And one of the things I like about him is he's highly skilled. They have elite centermen right now in Edmonton, but they're looking for elite wingers to be able to play with those elite centermen. Yamamoto would be a guy that fits that bill, but they can afford to go on the outside and maybe take a smaller forward now, because like what you said, Sam, they have bigger players to protect, and they can just go forward and try and build now that elite skill set they want to play with.
Led by Wayne Gretzky, general manager Peter Chiarelli, making their way to the podium for the 22nd pick in this 2017 first round. Defeated San Jose and then lost in that great series against the Anaheim Ducks as the Oilers made their way back into the postseason. Peter Chiarelli built a Stanley Cup winner with the Boston Bruins, and now has had enough time to definitely put his fingerprints on this group, both by drafting and then through the free agency market. A couple of astute pickups last year. Russell, the extension, and then Milan Lucic added some size.
The Edmonton Oilers are proud to select from the Spokane Chiefs, Kyler Yamamoto.
We talked about size and the lack of it, that you could go a little bit smaller. Kyler Yamamoto is 5'9", 160 pounds.
They targeted this player. They wanted him, and they were hoping that he would be there when they picked at 22, the first time they've done since 2008. And you know what? For Yamamoto, he's just that high elite IQ, that high skill that gets things done. He played a little bit of center, but he's better on the wing. This is a pick where they fill a need in Edmonton. They need scoring wingers, guys that can make plays, and that's what they're getting in Yamamoto.
Born in Spokane, plays for the Spokane Chiefs of the Western Hockey League, but moved to Los Angeles to play his bantam hockey for the LA Junior Kings, which gives you an idea of Wayne Gretzky and the influence of LA. Grandma and Grandpa with Hawaiian and Japanese heritage, so there's that part of it to the story with the lineage. And this is a skilled player who took skating lessons from Tyler Johnson's mom when he grew up.
One thing that Debbie Johnson talked about in training both of her son and Kyler Yamamoto is the fact that not only were they skating in their preschool skates, but they were puck handling at that time. And that's why he has the ability now to handle the puck at high speeds. 42 goals in the Western Hockey League, made good things happen with Jared Anderson Dolan, his linemate.
Now Harrison's just showing off at 6'3" and 5'9", Kyler Yamamoto. Jeff.
Alongside Russ Yamamoto, proud father right now, what's going through your mind? All those road trips, we think, to Seattle, to Los Angeles, to Wenatchee, what goes through your mind right now?
I'm so proud of this kid. He's done it. I don't know what to say. I'm really speechless. He's awesome.
He started skating at the age of 22 months, he told us. Tyler Johnson's mom, Debbie, Tyler Johnson of Tampa, teaching him how to skate. Take us back to the early years.
He would just kind of follow Tyler around out there, and he would try to imitate the moves with him, and it was kind of neat because Kyler and my other son Keanu could actually do the moves sometimes, and it was pretty cool.
He said he was jealous because your other son learned to skate two months before he did at 20 months. Yep. Congratulations, Dad.
Thank you.
Darren.
42 goals, 99 points this year. Also picked up almost 50 penalty minutes, so he doesn't shy away just because he's 5'9". But that's right on the edge, right, of the new game, 5'9".
Right on the edge. You see what Johnny Gaudreau's done in Calgary, and the little guy has more of an opportunity now than ever.
Peter Chiarelli made the pick. He's with Elliott.
Louis DeBrusque, who knows your organization, said that you guys targeted Yamamoto and it was a player that you wanted. Why was that?
Well, he has such a love for the game. At his size, he's had a lot of challenges, but he's a gritty player with a great offensive touch. He goes after guys in the forecheck. So despite his stature, we saw a lot of things. Big heart, big skill, and can play all positions and has some real leadership.
You've had a busy couple of days. Eberle Forsstrom yesterday, Chris Russell signing today. Is your business outside the draft done, or could we see more?
Well, for tonight it is. How about that?
All right, that's good enough. Thank you very much, Peter.
Thanks, Elliot.
Darren?
Thank you. When you guys talked about playing down in the lineup, Kyler Yamamoto isn't the player that plays in your bottom six.
Well, you know, with his hockey IQ, I think he can play anywhere. But no question, I think they're looking at him to try and step in and take one of those top positions on the wing in the top six is what I look at him doing. And when you have Draisaitl, you have McDavid, you have Nugent Hopkins, that's a plethora of centers that like to dish the puck to a guy that can score 42 goals in WHL.
Tara.
Hey, Darren, thank you very much. Kyler, Elliot was just talking to Peter Chiarelli about the fact that they were targeting you. Did you have a sense that this is where you were going to go?
I thought LA might be interested, but this is a team I wanted to go to. They took me out, and I just got the best feeling from them, and I'm really excited to be a part of the Edmonton Oilers.
Your grandpa Don isn't here in the building today, but he had a very interesting way of convincing you to skate when you were a kid. What was that?
I was a little bit shy when I went on the ice. You know, my brother was always skating around me, but I would always lay on the ice, and he would put M&Ms on the ice in a line, and I loved M&Ms growing up as a kid, and I would skate to him, and that's how he got me skating.
Very sweet stuff. Congratulations to you, Kyler.
Thank you.
Darren?
Yeah, sweet. You can say that. What is it with these small skilled forwards and the skating lessons? Johnny Gaudreau, his dad would put Skittles on the ice. Now we've got M&Ms.
Well, it's the best way to do it. If you're a smaller player, how do you avoid some of the physical contact? Here's what you do. You skate and you show that escapability. And excellent feature on Kyler Yamamoto, how he grew up following his brother Keanu around. And that's really what made him the player he was today. Got to play with Keanu in his last year in Spokane. And for Kyler, he's been a snipe show ever since he went into the league. 23 goals, 19 goals, 42 this year.
Arizona Coyotes. What a wild couple of days it's been. Well, a couple of weeks, really. John Chyka, ready to make their second selection.
Thank you to the great city of Chicago and the Blackhawks organization. Quick hello to our fans at the Scottsdale Ice Den Arena. Thank you for your support. The Arizona Coyotes are pleased to select from the Charlottetown Islanders, Pierre-Olivier Joseph.
Arizona entered with two picks. They traded that seventh overall selection to the New York Rangers. So this is at number 23, and they go with a defenseman who has to fill out in a big way. But this is also a defenseman that his brother's been drafted in the National Hockey League and has some skill at being able to move that puck.
Oh, no doubt. But he is skinny, and you can see it there. I mean, he could play hide-and-seek with a phone pole, and you might not be able to see him. You see his brother, Matthew, we saw in the MasterCard Memorial Cup, a Tampa Bay pick, a third-rounder, and felt really strongly about his brother and his brother's prospects. In fact, they got to play each other a couple of times this year, one being in Charlottetown, the other in St. John. That smile, that's not fake. That's not just today. That's all day, every day with this guy.
Unbelievable. You know what I loved about him was when we talked to him at the Combine, he said he likes the game of Mark Edward Vlasic. I mean, he was the only one that I remember that talked about a defensive defenseman, a guy that plays a complete hard game to play against. And I love that answer for him. That's who he models his game after, a guy that shuts people down, can produce a little bit offensively. This is a nice foundational pick for the Arizona Coyotes.
We hear with these kids all the time, or from the general manager, he's got to fill out, he's got to put on some weight. Pierre wants to play at 185. He's got to put on 25 pounds.
He's got to eat some pasta.
Look how tall he is, though. I mean, and that's the thing. You're looking at all these young kids that come into the draft, and there's no question most of them nowadays, because of the speed and the skill of the game, they're going to be slight, and they're going to have to put on weight. But they're 18 years old, and who knows what they're going to be in 3, 4, 5 years when they become man strong. I mean, the frame is there for him to really fill out, and the game that he plays will bode really well for that.
This theme of moms tonight continues, because when brothers played, she warned them both. No fighting. They got offsetting minors at one point, but there absolutely no fighting was going to happen. He also loves doing homework, too. And that's a great little bit of advice to everybody. He's very open about it and very into his studies. So Pierre Oliver Joseph, left-handed shooting defenseman at 6 foot, going to the Arizona Coyotes. Tara?
Well, congratulations to you. You know, your brother was absolutely beaming, but I'm going to quote you. You said, Matthew might be a little bit annoying on draft weekend, but he'll be great support. What's he been like?
I mean, he's been incredible for the last 17 years, I guess. He has been there tonight for me and all season long, so I'm more than appreciable for him to be there.
And did you have a sense that you might go this early?
I mean, you don't want to put any expectation. You just want to go there and have fun, and I enjoyed a lot of the moment right now.
And your family, I mean, they've been through this before, but it never stops being nerve-wracking. So just how grateful are you to them?
I'm more than grateful. I put all my effort, but they're there since I'm young. They come and bring me to the arena every morning, and I'm more than grateful for them to be there.
Well, speaking of your family, Jeff Merrick is with them in the stands. Jeff?
St. John Sea Dogs as well, Quebec League champions. Your thoughts on your brother getting selected first round NHL. You've been through it.
Yeah, I think it's unbelievable for him. I'm so happy for him. I worked so hard all year, and finally being here in sister's draft like that, it's a good moment for a family, and we're all really proud of him.
Speaking of the family, tell us who's here and who had the biggest smile on their face.
I don't know. I think we're all happy, and my grandmother was crying. My parents are really happy about that. I think it's a great moment as a family, and he deserves it. He worked really hard, and really, really proud of him.
And no fighting, right? We saw what happened at the end of the season between Charlottetown and St. John. No fighting, right?
Yeah, no fighting, but we're not in the same division now, so probably not going to play against each other a lot.
Congratulations to you and the family, and certainly your brother.
Thank you.
Darren?
Thank you. It's been an amazing few days for the Arizona Coyotes. Mike Smith was traded. Shane Doan moved on. Dave Tippett was relieved of his duties. They had a parting of the ways yesterday, so it's nice that they're adding a piece to the puzzle there and a high-end prospect. Kevin Cheveldayoff, the Winnipeg Jets were originally set to pick 13th, but they swapped positions, and they are now in the position of 24, which previously belonged to the Columbus Blue Jackets. Kevin Cheveldayoff and company much higher last year after making that big jump in the lottery and landed a Finn in Patrick Laine. Curious, so this is a very patient organization. They don't go off the board very often, but when they do, there's an express real purpose. They don't exactly follow the script entirely.
Well, I love the fact that they keep the same people and allow them to do what they do best. Scout players, draft them and develop them. Being patient is key.
I'd like to thank the Chicago Blackhawks and the fantastic city of Chicago for a wonderful week. I'd like to say hello to all the great fans back in Winnipeg at our draft party at Club Region Casino. With our first selection, the Winnipeg Jets are proud to select Christian Vasilainen, Frölunda, Swedish Elite League.
And that's a Finn playing in the Swedish Elite League in Christian Vasilainen. One of those players that really could have gone anywhere from top 10 at the back end of the top 10 down to outside of the first round.
Well, no question about it. If you go back to the start of the year, I think this is a guy who was definitely in the top 10. So he started the season in Frölunda, but on his way out of Frölunda, things did not end well. You heard Jeff Merrick talk about it before two breaks ago, saying that, hey, it just didn't work out well for him. And that maybe spoke to some of the character issues where teams would be worried about him. He came into our interview and he was calm, cool, collected. He was leaned back. It was like he was sitting in a rocking chair. He was comical. He was funny. But when he gets out onto the ice, he gives you that two-way center versatility. And when it comes to this guy, you go back to having being loaned now to go back to the Finnish league after playing in Frölunda when it didn't go well, had trouble finding his stride. But whenever he played with his own age group, he played extremely well. And Jeff also mentioned the under-18s, which he led that tournament with 13 points in 7 games. Finland ended up with a silver medal, and that put him back on the map.
That saved his chances of being a first-rounder.
No question, because really he went kind of from a top 10 guy, then he went down to being like a middling guy, and here he is in the bottom 11 picks of the draft, going 24th to Winnipeg.
A couple of Finnish wingers in Winnipeg right now. Patrick Laine.
And I'm sure that they're hoping for some chemistry there at some point down the road.
6'3", 209. The Winnipeg Jets don't have problems scoring goals, but a power forward on the left-hand side or right-hand side, because he can play there as well. This is a good pick by Kevin Cheveldayoff. As you mentioned, stock cupboards for them. They have a lot of prospects they can go to, a little bit different than what they've been choosing, a little abrasive and maybe a long shot, but I like the pick.
Montreal coming up next at 25. Tara Sloan, we know your musical background. Christian Vasilainen likes to rap.
Christian Vasilainen likes to rap, but unfortunately in Buffalo, he did not rap for us. However, tonight is worthy of a celebration. Will there be rapping later on?
I don't know if after the draft, but we'll see.
The prospect of you playing on a team with Patrick Laine, what's that like to think about?
Yeah, that would be awesome, actually. That would be great.
I know you had some interesting interviews at the scouting combine in Buffalo. Was Winnipeg one of those?
No, actually, I think we had a good talk there, and just normal stuff.
You know what? I have to ask you, just because we're here on live TV, Can you throw down something for us, please?
That's not today. Maybe someday, hopefully.
Darren, maybe 3 times a charm next time.
I guarantee you Patrick Laine would have taken her up on that opportunity. Elliot.
He'll save his talking for the ice. I think that's what we're learning right now with him. You know, he had Jeff Merrick talked tonight about how he had some powerful things to say about Frölunda. When you did your research into him, what did you learn?
Well, again, we've done a lot of different things in the background and checking on him. And he's a player that, again, we had very, very highly ranked in our group. Obviously, we went into the week looking at picking 13 and came out of here picking 24. So, he figured into our plans probably higher up in the there. And we were comfortable with everything we looked at. And we're excited to have a big, powerful player like that who can drive the net. Can make plays, and we're excited about it.
Thank you very much, Kevin. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Darren?
It's just interesting. You see Edmonton go with 5'9", skill guy, and Winnipeg comes back with 6'3", power forward. And we talk about how the game's transitioning right now. Montreal up next at 25. A disappointing postseason. We know that. Made midseason coaching change on the heels of the PK Subban trade, and then dealt Mikhail Sergachev away. So a couple of young defensemen out of their group. Shea Weber's involved now. So Marc Bergevin is, this is fluid with Montreal.
If you're looking to ignite the crowd in Montreal, there's no better player than Jonathan Drouin, who'd be able to play in his hometown and do it. But we'll see if there's a complimentary pick, or we'll see if there's possibly someone here who would replace Mikhail Sergachev.
Yeah, I was going to say, do they go a defenseman in that regard because they traded the blue chip prospect? Or offensively, they just can't score, and they don't have that big guy down the middle.
They need a centerman,
so
big time.
There's two needs there. Mm-hmm. One's been forced on them, and one's been long sought after to solve it. Marc Bergevin and the Montreal Canadiens about to make the 25th pick.
On behalf of the Montreal Canadiens, Jeff Molson would like to thank the Chicago Blackhawks organization, the whole city of Chicago. J'aimerais aussi saluer tous les partisans des Canadiens de Montréal partout au Québec et au Canada. And also congratulate the Pittsburgh Penguins for the Stanley Cup. Trevor Timmons will make our selection.
Special hello to back home to Mr. Elmer Benning, our longtime scout of over 40 years for the Montreal Canadiens. On behalf of Elmer, I'd like to make this pick from St. Cloud, Ryan Poehling.
There's your center. And at 6'2", approaching 190 pounds, there's your big center.
Yeah, they have him even listed a little bit taller at times, so he's a kid still growing. And you know what? This is that organizational need the Montreal Canadiens have to have. And they liken him a little bit to Jordan Staal, that two-way centerman that can play a safe, sound game, produce offensively. That's your staple down the middle they're looking for, and it's been a need for a long time for Montreal, and Marc Bergevin has addressed that today with this pick.
There might have been better options for him to go and play elsewhere, but he wanted to play with his twin brothers. His twin brothers, Luke and Jack, were at St. Cloud, so he fast-tracked through high school so that he could be able to go to St. Cloud and play with his twin brothers. In fact, they make up a line. What's pretty cool is, as being the youngest player in the NCAA this year, he wasn't worried about points. He was worried more about family issues. He knew he was going to play. Only put up 13 points in the 35 games at St. Cloud this year. But what's pretty neat is the fact that at the end of the year, with his season being over, the U.S. Under-18 program parachuted him in to play in the Under-18s. That team went from being a nobody team to winning a gold medal at that Under-18 tournament. And the fact that he was parachuted in was accepted by all his mates when that team spends most of his time together all year long and then produces 6 points in the four games tells me a lot about this guy's ability, A, to be a good solid character, and B, to be a player who's able to adjust his game, going from the college level, playing bit minutes and getting a lesser offensive role, to going in and being a top offensive guy with the under-18s.
And I think what you're going to see is a big turnaround for a player in his second year of college.
Yeah.
You know, that first year, it's a learning curve. He's the youngest guy in the league, like you mentioned. And then, boom, he fills out, comes in the next year, and produces even more.
The cheer you hear is for Chicago. Up next at 26, Marc Bergevin, general manager of the Montreal Canadiens, also has a connection with this organization, the Chicago Blackhawks. Much the same way that Dale Tallon, he worked with Dale Tallon when the two of them were with the organization.
I like the quote on the screen there. Bob Motzko, who said Nico Hischier was the best guy we played against as the head coach for the U.S. at the World Juniors. Poehling's going to be a real impact player at this level and next.
Won a high school championship. And this is a player that played with his brother. If you can play in a line as three brothers and still have some semblance of a puck left, it's impressive. Down to the podium and Gary Bettman.
We have a trade. Relax, you're going to get to do it again. Chicago trades pick number 26 to Dallas in exchange for pick number 29 and pick number 70. So Chicago trades 26 to Dallas in exchange for 29 and 70, which is a third round pick, so you get to get excited again. We'll be back.
They were ready to go. Chicago slides back three spots. Tara?
We're here with Ryan Poehling. Ryan, your uncle, Stan Palmer, was drafted by the Montreal Canadiens in 1977. There is a kind of poetry here. Did it occur to you that this might be the way things went?
Yeah, I know. I didn't see it coming. I mean, tonight, I mean, at the combine, I had 30 interviews. So, I mean, everyone, it was open for everyone. So, I mean, to get drafted like an organization like Toronto or Montreal is just an honor, and I'm very excited it happened.
You had a lot to cope with this past year, being the youngest player in the NCAA. You had a lot to adjust to. What does it feel like that it's just finally happened?
Yeah, I mean, it's been a long year. I mean, like you said, I was in college, and I mean, with all these interviews and stuff, it was a long process. So, I'm glad it's over, to be honest.
Well, we hope you have a fantastic and easy night, Darren.
Yeah, he'll catch a break one of these days because he had a hole in one when he was 9. So things coming together for the Paling family. 3 kids playing NCAA. Montreal with that 25th pick. 3 Canadian teams in a 4-pick span. Now it's Chicago giving way to Dallas. Dallas will pick 26th. Mark Bergevin standing by with Elliot.
Mark, they talked about what a great under-18 Paling had. Was that where you looked at him and said, that's going to be our guy?
Well, Trevor and our staff really look at him closely. I've talked to him this morning, matter of fact, and impressive kid. Plays, in our eyes, plays the right way, plays a whole sheet of ice, and the centerman on top of it. So we were very pleased to select him.
He's got a huge frame. Like, how big do you think he's going to get?
Well, he puts the time in and he fills out. He could be a pretty good sized centerman, and you know, in this league right now, they're hard to find unless you draft them. They're really hard to find, so we're really happy to get him.
Finally, Mark, I want to ask you, you've been busy, you've been looking around. Is anything going on?
How do you know? Well, at GMs right now, there's 31 of us who've all been shopping, so like I said, expect the unexpected.
I like that. Thank you very much, Mark.
Thank you,
Darren.
Thank you. Segment 30 thoughts. That's how I know. Jim Nill, Dallas Stars, back up to the stage. They picked Miro Heiskanen with a 3rd overall pick. What do you think would cause them to make the slight jump from 29 to 26? What do they have their eye on?
I had them taking the goaltender, Jake Oettinger, with the 29th pick. And maybe they feel that St. Louis was going to jump up and get him. I still feel that Oettinger's going to be the guy, and that they felt they had to move up those 3 spots to get him. And it cost them the 70th pick in order to do so. You just felt with the goaltending situation, the way it's been in Dallas, a guy who's playing in college at BU, it makes a lot of sense for me here.
Obviously, there's a player in mind they wanted.
From Boston University, Jake Oettinger.
The much maligned goaltending of the Dallas Stars gets a top prospect. They've had that before. But this is the player who stepped in and took that number one job at BU.
Well, I got a whole lot to say about this. I mean, I'm never, ever a big fan of selecting goalies in the first round. And the Jack Campbell experiment for Dallas has not worked out particularly well. Now, having said that, when you have multiple picks in a draft that has middling players, it does give you the options to do that. And obviously, the intel and the scuttlebutt and the chatter was, we think St. Louis likes that guy. So you know what? We better leapfrog St. Louis in order to make sure that we get Jake Oettinger, and that's exactly what they did. It cost them the 70th pick to do it. But Oettinger, I just love this guy. When he walked into the room with us at the combine, he just reeked of presence. It was unbelievable. And again, one of those guys shakes your hand, good hard grip, looks you in the eye. Not cocky, but very, very confident in his abilities. Knows exactly what he has to do. Works out with Charlie Lindgren in the summer, who's a guy who's tried to work for everything that he's got on his way up through the Montreal Canadiens organization, using that as a blueprint for making his way to the National Hockey League, I think is a pretty good way to go about his business.
6'4", 212.
When he walked in the room, I thought he was a defenseman. This is one of those goaltenders that he said already at 18 years of age, he's starting to learn to lean his body down, which tells me that the physique he has is incredible. But he's also very flexible, plays a poised type of game. And you know what? For me, I thought for sure he was going to go in this first round. If you're going to take a goaltender, this is the guy you're going to want to take. The Dallas Stars have had problems with goalies. Pick one to see if he pans out in a draft like this.
You know, you may have been onto something with your initial assessment of Jake Oettinger, thinking he was a defenseman, because he played that position until he was 10.
He's huge. He's a big kid. And, you know, I like that.
That's fairly recent for an elite goaltender.
I like the fact that he's not a string bean. He's got muscles. He's pliable. He can take up a lot of the net. But he says positioning is his key, but he can still make that dramatic save.
Gary Bettman at the podium. That could mean one thing.
We have a trade. St. Louis trades pick number 27 in this year's draft, Yuri Laterra, and a conditional first-round pick in 2018 to Philadelphia for Braden Schenn.
Philadelphia, you're on the clock.
Well, that's interesting. They started the night, the Philadelphia Flyers, by picking a Brandon Wheatking, and now they trade one in Braden Schenn. This is an interesting trade, because Schenn looked like he'd finally found himself in that mix in Philadelphia the last couple of years.
Well, it tells me this, that they were thinking Jake Oettinger. Because as soon as Oettinger was taken, then the ball started to roll and make that trade. They can't get their guy, so here's another option on the table for Ron Hextall in Philadelphia.
You think goalie?
I think it also tells me they think Nolan Patrick can play.
A goalie right there. Jake Oettinger, the only reason he's playing goal is because the goalie got called up to another team and he fell into it from defense as we continue in the first round in Chicago.
This program is brought to you by Golf Town, your destination for everything golf in Canada. Put away the sticks and dust off your clubs because now we golf.
Experience Control GX for Men, the first shampoo with a brain. So smart, it reduces gray gradually. The more you shampoo, the less gray you have. How smart is that? Gradually reduce gray with Control GX shampoo from Just for Men.
Nothing is better than a Swiss Chalet quarter chicken dinner. Juicy, fresh, never frozen rotisserie chicken, golden fresh cut fries, and that famous Chalet sauce. But wait, two of them for just $14.99? I stand corrected. This offer is only here for 14 days until June 25th.
When trailblazers need gear, Woods is there. When explorers need shelter, Woods is there. When defenders need protection and adventurers need inspiration, Woods is there. We've been proudly outfitting Canadians for over 130 years, helping you explore further. Woods.
Sportsnet Now, live stream sports. Visit snnow.ca for details.
Welcome back to Chicago, where I am standing by with Jake Oettinger, the very first goaltender to go in the 2017 NHL entry draft. Back to back from Lakeville, Minnesota. What's that like, you and Ryan Poehling?
Yeah, it's such an unbelievable feeling, and you know, to be here sharing this experience with probably my best friend Ryan is, you know, I can't even put into words how cool that is. And you know, I know there's a lot of really proud Lakeville North Panthers back in Lakeville right now, and you know, couldn't be more honored to be representing Lakeville and to be sharing with Ryan.
And Darren, I know he's rocking the Minnesota Sox.
That is outstanding right there. I was actually looking at our monitor, and I was about to ask our director, Paul Hemming, what are we seeing here? But that makes sense now. Ron Hextall, Philadelphia Flyers, trading up.
Philadelphia selects from Ontario Hockey League Sault Ste. Marie Greyhounds, Morgan Frost.
So on the heels of taking Nolan Patrick, number two, Morgan Frost is 27. And there's the hug with his dad.
Well, Andy Frost, the longtime announcer at the Air Canada Centre for the Toronto Maple Leafs, no longer with the club in that capacity. So he's had a great opportunity to go and watch his son Morgan play, and he's got to be oh so proud of where Morgan has come from. First of all, playing his minor hockey in Barrie, and then getting the opportunity with Sault Ste. Marie and a couple of guys at camp, a couple of guys out of the lineup. You go back to 2 years ago, Zach Sinishin.
There he is. He shadowed dad to the rink.
how nice is that? And so on this journey, he's had the opportunity to step into the Sault Ste. Marie lineup and get minutes as a 16-year-old that he might not have gotten otherwise. And that really helped sped up this guy's development.
But still a surprise at this
point. Yeah, I had him pegged as probably a mid-second round guy right in that 45 range. But I know some teams were talking about him lately. And I thought teams felt that they might be able to get up into that second round for those who weren't there, and those who were there thought maybe he'd be able to get them in that 45 range.
Jeff Merrick with a guy who gets followed around for people just to voice their answering machines.
That's right, legendary announcer Andy Frost. You know, the Andy Frost hockey pool is legendary, former in-house announcer for the Toronto Maple Leafs, but this has to be your greatest hockey thrill, proud hockey dad.
Jeff, you know, you and I have known each other for a long time, and yeah, we've gone through a lot together, but this is really a highlight. It's a highlight for him, you know. I just drove him to the practices and drove him to all the games and paid for everything, but you know, it's a great event for him, and he never complained ever. He wants it, you know, and he's going to Philly, and you know, he's probably going back to the Sioux for the next year anyway. But
nothing wrong with that. And now he's with Tara Sloan. Tara,
thanks, Jeff. That is one proud papa, your dad Andy. You grew up around the game. You really enjoyed seeing the guys back outside of the dressing rooms. What did you like most about just being around it?
Yeah, I think you know, all those times when I was younger, it was such a great experience for me, and you know, just kind of to get a visual of what it's like to be a pro and just kind of see that guys, you know, it was so great for me and so crucial for me.
I have to say, you look a little taken aback. Is this not something you expected to happen tonight?
I don't know. I wouldn't say that. I'm just really excited to go to Philly. So.
Well, congratulations to you.
Thank you very much.
Darren.
Sorry to throw everybody off by mentioning an answering machine, too. They don't exist anymore. It's all voicemail. what era are you in? Yeah, Andy, he's signing autographs. He's getting some passes that he'll meet his son Morgan Frost down. His numbers, Morgan's numbers in the game still has to evolve a little bit. Ottawa now at 28 as they jump into this. That long, thrilling playoff run that ended in double overtime in Game 7 of the Pittsburgh Penguins in the Eastern Conference Final. Per Dorion, what an incredible first year he had running things with the Ottawa Senators and some acquisitions and some highs and lows. But now at 28, they have Daniel Alfredson, part of this management group. Guy Boucher stepped in and did an incredible amount of work putting in a new system here. But we're going to see Pierre Dorion's stamp start to evolve with this club.
Yeah, no doubt. And here's a guy who really made his way, Pierre Dorion did, through the scouting world. But with Ottawa's long run this year, he didn't get the opportunity to get out there and see guys as he normally does. So really heavily leaning on Trent Mann, who's the guy behind Guy Boucher there as their head scout, to be able to run the draft, to get across all of these places into Europe, into North America, to try and find players. So this definitely a situation where Pierre Dorion, who likes to get out and see those top guys, had to kind of sit back in his office throughout the playoffs and keep watching video and learning about players that way.
Scouting background, and he knew how painful it was when you trade a top prospect like he did this year at the trade deadline.
It's difficult to do that, and now there's a guy who might end up playing for the Vancouver Canucks as early as next year.
Yeah.
In Jonathan Dolan.
Ottawa Senators at number 28. Pierre Dorion and company both make this selection. Won a couple of rounds, and within a bounce of the Stanley Cup Final.
Before making our selection, the Ottawa Senators would like to thank the Chicago Blackhawks and the city of Chicago for their hospitality. The Ottawa Senators are proud to select les Sénateurs d'Ottawa sont très fiers de choisir Shane Bowers from Waterloo of the USHL.
Heard a lot about Shane Bowers. A lot about his game and potential.
He's what you would deem a safe pick, and that's a tough word to use in scouting these days, but because of his character, his high character, and his ability to play a two-way game, he's not going to dazzle you in any one particular part of the game with his shooting, his skating, or his playmaking, but he's really good in all of those areas. So if you're looking for that dynamic element to the game, Shane Bowers is probably not a guy that you would look at. More Jonathan Taves-like, as he's in the building here.
Yeah, you know what?
When it comes to Bowers, here's what I really like about his character. So he's from the Halifax area. He skates in the summertime with Sidney Crosby. He gets drafted into the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League, doesn't go. He goes back into the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League draft, gets drafted by the St. John Sea Dogs, and doesn't go. He was committed from day one to go and play in the USHL and to go the college route. How hard would that be for a guy who lives in the Maritimes to turn down two Maritime teams to go to Waterloo and play? That would be a very difficult thing to do, especially after you've watched Nathan MacKinnon do it, after you've watched Sidney Crosby do it. Guys like Brad Marchand, who all went the way of the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League, he decided to buck the trend because he felt it was the most important thing for him and his development. He's part of the leadership group with P.K. O'Hanley. The head coach has been there for 1,000 years. They have dinner over at his house once a week. P.K. O'Hanley couldn't say enough about this guy's character.
A maturity, and that's what I like about him too. When we talk to him, you could tell he just, it's not a swagger, it's a confidence. There's an assuredness there in his talking, knowing exactly what he wants to do. For the Ottawa Senators, they can wait a little bit for him. He's going to go to university, he's going to get bigger, he's going to get stronger, he's going to develop his game. And like you said, he's one of those guys that does a little bit of everything well.
And that's why I keep thinking there might be a little bit more to his game.
Yes.
To come.
He was 10th in the USHL in scoring, so I mean, he's got game, no question. Can he bring it up to that level?
Up next, but right now, the newest member of the Ottawa Senators, Tara.
Thanks, Darren. Well, you had your Brandon moment. I'm having my Halifax moment. Shane Bowers, so thrilled for you. Talking about the route you took to the USHL, kind of an unconventional route for a Canadian kid. Why did you decide to do that?
Yeah, I mean, for me, I just thought it was the best thing for my development. And, you know, I don't regret making the decision, and it's been awesome. And, you know, being here right now, you know, makes it all worth it.
We know from chatting with you in Buffalo, you're a pretty superstitious guy. Is there anything you did or wore today?
No, nothing today, but, you know, I kept thinking to myself, you know, was there something I did or should have done? But now that it's over, I can kind of relax.
I don't think you needed anything. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Darren.
Talk to him about the relationship with all those kids around Halifax. He does some power skating with Brad Marchand. Skates in the summer at times with Sidney Crosby. They throws in, I taught at Sidney's hockey school. And I thought that was really impressive. I think I caught him off guard with how my reaction. And he said, well, actually, I kind of just push pucks around at Sidney's hockey school.
So that's up there. That's up there.
Yeah. He likes to surf, and he's going to be a teammate of Jake Ottinger, who went 2 picks before him at Boston University. Shane Bowers building on this growing NHL community out of Halifax. He bumped into Jake Ottinger at the Combine just recently. Very super. You were all over the superstitious conversation.
Oh, yeah.
Elliot.
Pierre, we're seeing Montreal take a center. You look at a center. Is this what we're looking at in the Atlantic Division? Lots of centers?
Lots of centers, Elliot. No, this was something that we'd really, a player that we really targeted. It's someone that we know is going to be in our lineup within a few years. Lots of skill, lots of good hockey sense, two things that we like. We know that he's got to get stronger, but we see a really bright future for this player.
He's going to college next year. Do you have an idea, maybe 2-3 years, or do you think it could be faster?
It depends how his growth goes. We always like to make sure that when we take a player out of college that they're ready to play the pro game as close to the NHL as possible. So whether it's 1, 2, or 3 years, we know he'll be a successful player in our lineup.
Thanks very much, Pierre.
Thank you.
Darren?
Elliot, thank you. Gathering on the stage, the host of the 2017 NHL Draft, the Chicago Blackhawks, who will now pick 29th after trading the 26th pick to the Dallas Stars.
Welcome, everybody. I'd like to start by giving a big thank you to the great fans here in Chicago. You guys came out and made this an incredible night, so really appreciate your support through the years. With our first pick in the 2017 draft, the Blackhawks are proud to select, you know,
I think there's a better way to do this. Back in 2006 and 2007, the Blackhawks drafted two players that changed the course of our franchise. I think it's only appropriate that we have those guys come up and make the selection. In 2006, with the third pick in the draft, the Blackhawks selected your captain, number 19, Jonathan Toews. The next year, in 2007, the first pick overall, Blackhawks selected number 88, Patrick Kane.
What's up, Chicago?
I tell you what, it's good to be back in the Madhouse on Madison. We got the best fans in the league. Thanks for coming out, making this a special night for all these young players. Obviously, this brings back a lot of great memories for the two of us. And we're happy to be here again to announce a big pick and the future of our hockey team. Kanner, you want to do the honors?
Just remember, I went two spots higher than Johnny, so. With the 29th pick, the Chicago Blackhawks select Henry Jokiharju.
That was impressive. A little bit of theater.
Oh, yeah.
From Stan Bowman and company to his captain and alternate captain, NHL MVP from a couple of years ago in Patrick Kane. Now they get to the pick in the 29th selection, and you've got two NHL superstars there. So where's this pick fall into the grand scheme of things?
Well, he's another guy who started to get some late love. As we move towards the combine and the draft, Jokiharju is one of those guys that they feel can play a real solid offensive game. And where it fits well for him is the fact that he plays for the Portland Winterhawks. The jersey's not going to have to change much for him. Playing for Mike Johnson there, who loves an offensive, up-tempo style of game. So Jokiharju is one of those guys that in that long list of Finns that we're starting to see now, really good in the back end. They can give you a two-way game, but they're not afraid to jump up. And I think if you go back in the history of Finnish defensemen, we thought so much of those guys being defensive defensemen, not so much adding the offensive side. But when you look at some of the highlights and his ability to jump up, he does have that offensive flair to his game.
Just a real solid skater is too. He's compact when you watch him skate, and I like the way he shoots the puck. Listen, the Chicago Blackhawks know how to pick him. There's no question about that. They rolled out the red carpet for him here. They obviously really liked this player because he was rated higher, but they felt they wanted to take him now, and they got the player they wanted.
3 points in the top prospects game for a defenseman. That was a record this year. So Jokiharju has that distinction to his name.
Defensively, it was a transition week for the Chicago Blackhawks. Trevor Van Riemsdyk dealt to the Carolina Hurricanes after the Vegas Golden Knights picked him up in the expansion draft. And Nick Chalmerson went to the Arizona Coyotes today in exchange for Connor Murphy. So they get a little bit younger in that regard. And now the fourth Finnish defenseman to go in the first 29 picks of this round. We knew they were great at goaltending. When the Finns put their minds to something, look out, they excel.
This is awesome.
First round pick in Chicago is spectacular when you're picked by the home team. But then Patrick Kane and Jonathan Toews stepping up and executing the way they did. Patrick Kane in 2007, three-time Stanley Cup champion, following and playing with Jonathan Toews, picked up in 2006, third overall. And they team up here in Chicago on Sportsnet, the first round of the NHL draft presented by Adidas.
brand new Toyota CHR.
With Boston Pizza's new halftime lunch, $10 gets you, and you're back to work in no time. Try Boston Pizza's halftime lunch with $10 combos.
Tester Dave loved how the CCM 2 bike hitch platform carrier kept his bike secure. Now we're going to test it by taking a little drive
on some square tires. Burn rubber.
The anti-wobble hitch pin keeps your bike secure and in place. See? Still secure. Do you hear ringing?
See more from our testers at canadiantire.ca/tested.
Atoms are all around us. When these electrostatic charges draw together, they constitute a chemical bond. They create powerful, eternal connections.
Visa Checkout is an easier way to pay online. With no payment and delivery info to fill out, you feel like you're one step ahead. Use Visa Checkout at pizzapizza.ca and get a free small pizza with your next purchase.
You're thinking chips again. We're thinking no. We're thinking pretzels, peanuts, Reese's Pieces, and Reese. We're thinking sweet and salty. We're thinking swalty. We're rethinking that last one. Mix with two new flavors. Mix things up.
Let's go. We got one.
The all-new Discovery. Land Rover, above and beyond.
After a quiet night, the action is starting to heat up. We had the Braden Schenn deal with Philadelphia and St. Louis. Now the Blues are about to make a second trade. After the Stanley Cup, Jim Rutherford said he would like to add some muscle and protection for Sidney Crosby. He's about to acquire Ryan Reeves, a close friend of the Oak family from Winnipeg, from the Blues. I understand Oscar Sundquist is going back to St. Louis in that deal. There's also some draft picks involved, including Pittsburgh's first-round selection, which is 31st overall, two picks away. So it's Ryan Reeves from St. Louis to Pittsburgh for Sundquist, and a couple of, and there are picks involved, including Pittsburgh's 31st. Darren?
Trumping the commissioner.
Yeah.
Nice job, Elliot, down the draft board. Nashville Predators here at what would traditionally be the end of the first round, but with the addition of the Vegas Golden Knights. Who's left? You've got two picks left in the first round. Before we get to that, the pick.
The Nashville Predators would like to congratulate the Pittsburgh Penguins on their Stanley Cup win and having a great battle with us. I'd like to say hello back to our fans in the Nashville Bridgestone Arena, the best catfish throwing fans in the league. And at this time, I'd like to introduce Jeff Kelty, our chief amateur scout, who will make our selection.
Nashville Predators select from the Sioux City Musketeers, Eli Tolvanen.
Going into this process, not a surprise that Eli Tolvanen's taken in the first round, but he cut it close. That's a sixth Finn selected tonight. The record was five in 2002, and we've already had a run on defensemen, but this is a left winger who makes things happen.
High-end guys. You go back to last year, three of the first five picks were Finns. When you look at Laine and Jesse Puljujärvi, Olli Juolevi, and the Finn invasion continues here with Eli Tolvanen. An interesting story in this guy. I go back to August when I was able to watch him at the under 20 camp. It was the Swedes, the Finns, the US and Canada playing in Plymouth, Michigan. And I was so impressed what this guy was able to do. Shoots the puck from anywhere. I mean, he is a shooter. There is no question about it. He will shoot it from anywhere on the ice. He's got accuracy, he's got depth to the shot, and he's got a really tricky release that for whatever reason, it seems to almost come from more back in his stance or whatever it is that seems to trick goaltenders. So that's why he was able to put up the number of goals he did in a tougher, older USHL league playing with Sioux City.
Loves Vladimir Tarasenko, and he shoots the puck just like him. The best left-handed shot of the forwards in the draft, in my opinion. And you talked about it. This guy shoots from everywhere. He led the USHL in shots, scored 30 goals in that league.
Once had 14 shots in a game.
There you go. I mean, this is it. He just looks to shoot the puck at all times. Never a bad thing.
The great thing about it is, you know, you love to score when you're taking that many shots. It's ingrained in your DNA. But the first couple of times that he scored a goal in the USHL, he didn't do anything. There's no celebration. His teammates came up to him and said, you're gonna start a line brawl here because the other team thinks you're showing them up. He didn't know what to do. So he basically invented his own celebration just as a form of survival.
You know, sometimes you go too far. Sometimes you don't do enough.
Elli Tolvanen, the 30th pick to Nashville, as we bring in Gary Bettman.
We have a trade involving the next pick. The Stanley Cup champion Pittsburgh Penguins trade pick number 31 in this year's draft, the last selection in the first round, and Oscar Sundquist to the St. Louis Blues in exchange for Ryan Reeves and pick number 51 in the second round in this year's draft. So, St. Louis, you have the 31st pick.
Doesn't look like either general manager is terribly thrilled about the deal. Sorry, I'm showing Jim Rutherford. Just another Finn?
Well, what's interesting at this part of the draft, Darren, is that you can get down further in the draft and slide back and still get pretty good guys. The lists are really all over the place. Once you got to about 25 and on, the lists are all over the place. So you feel you're still going to get a good player when you move down to 51, and obviously St. Louis has a target here.
Well, I know Nashville made a good pick because the general manager of the year made it. Here's David Poile with Elliot.
You know, the comparison being made was a guy who looked really good for you before he got hurt, Kevin Fiala. Do you think that's a good comparison?
I do think that's a good comparison. You know, the last few years we've really been looking to get faster and we're looking for offense. And we've taken a lot of forwards in the last few years. It's worked out good for us. And if he turns out as well as Kevin Fiala, this looks like he's turned out, that'll be a real good pick for us.
You know, you just came off a very emotional season. Do you look at it, David, as I'm coming back with the same group next year, or do you think you're going to tinker?
Well, I don't think I'll tinker too much, but again, we're sort of down a man already after expansion, losing James Neal. That's a big hole to fill, and, you know, we're going to promote some younger guys, but, you know, on the other hand, maybe we've got to be a team that has to look a little bit on July 1st for free agency to see whether we can get a top nine forward, maybe to replace Neal.
You know, everybody talks about your top 4D. I assume you're not letting any one of those guys go.
Yeah, they're pretty good, and they were a big reason why we got where we are. I've traded a lot of defensemen the last few years, and I think I better stop that, so... not too much tinkering. I'd like to add, and maybe free agency is the way to do it.
All right. Thank you very much, David. Appreciate your talk. Thank you. Darren?
That's a franchise whose fan base grew by leaps and bounds through that playoff run. St. Louis Blues, Doug Armstrong, to the podium for the second time in the last 11 picks. They had the 20th overall selection. Rob Thomas from the London Knights, a forward. Now, moving up to get the 31st pick, sacrificing Ryan Reeves in that trade with the Pittsburgh Penguins. There's a couple of names out there. Cole Lind, Kelowna.
Isaac Ratcliffe, he's a size guy that would fit well playing in the Western Conference. Cole Lind is more of a skilled guy, 87 points in the Western Hockey League with the Kelowna Rockets. There are a couple of different ways in which the St. Louis Blues can go here. Robert Thomas, the center, you have to wonder, do they go back to the well there, or do they look maybe at a defenseman here at this spot?
St. Louis Blues changed coaches. Mike Yeo's now in charge. It wasn't the total reset that Doug Armstrong kept promising us. They're going to miss Ryan Reeves, and as much out of that room, because he was a real integral part of that room.
It's a great pick. I think it's a great trade sense
Pittsburgh,
by
right?
Pittsburgh. Absolutely get that muscle there. But, yeah, maybe a little size here for St. Louis they'll be looking for, up the middle potentially.
St. Louis Blues are proud to select from the Moscow Dynamo, Klim Kostin.
That poor guy had to sweat it out, didn't he?
Well, you see the exhale. He's in that green room.
Yeah.
There was 8 prospects in the green room behind the stage tonight. And that, thank you, Paul Hemming, director, that tells you everything you need to know. All alone in that room, and he's been all alone in that room for a long time.
He sure has. But I'm going to tell you right now, guys, I absolutely love this pick. If you take everything aside, he's a top 10 talent all day, every single day. He's got size, speed, skill. He can play the game any way you want to play
it. But the numbers weren't there this year.
So the big problem with Klim Kostin was the fact that in December, he got hurt. But I got to see him five times in November in our CIBC Canada-Russia series, and he impressed me. Never backed down once from the physical play, going hard to the net, and in fact, behind the play was a little dirty at times. The most telling moment for me in going back to that series in November, we took a charter plane going back to the Ontario Hockey League. The Russians were at the front of the plane, the media in the middle, and the Western Hockey League, and the rest of the people at the back of the plane. Valerie Bragan, the head coach, who really likes his older players, went and sat down and had an animated 15-minute conversation with this guy. You're good. You can be better. Continue to work. You're the type of player that I like to have on my team. You're just a little too young right now. He says Valerie Brogan's the best coach he's ever had. I look at the full package that this guy brings to the table. Tough to judge because of the shoulder surgery. But what was really important for him was the fact that he did his rehab in the Detroit area. That allowed all kinds of teams to go in there, meet with him, get a feel for what it was like character-wise, because I think they had a pretty good book on him of what he was like player-wise.
Well, there's one person that we know can relate to exactly what Klim Kostin went through tonight in being left in that room by himself. And you go back to the draft that was held at the All-Star game in Carolina, and Phil Kessel, last pick taken, Alexander Ovechkin snapping the pictures, and it's worked out pretty good for Phil Kessel, who found his game, changed teams, new contract, and now a two-time Stanley Cup champion.
Who's buying Kostin the car, though?
He was a mystery player, though, because he could have slept mid second round, or he could have gone a little bit if you wanted to really take a chance.
No question. There's a couple of issues here, and they always talk about the Russian players and worried about them going back and playing. He's already turned down the Canadian Hockey League. He says he won't play there, so maybe that was a bit of a challenge to him. But where Klim Kostin, he's still got 2 years left on his contract with Dynamo Moscow. The problem is, the old ownership went out of business. And unlike the rules in North America, the new ownership isn't necessarily honoring the old deal. So that contract still has to be settled for this young man. There is no question, though, with his rehab in Detroit, that he wants to stay and play in North America. The Canadian Hockey League doesn't seem to be an option for him at this point. The Coot and the Ice own his rights right now. They just got a new coach in James Patrick. That'll be interesting to see that ever plays out. But the AHL or the NHL are seemingly the only options. And I think that's partially what scared away teams, that if he does start in the AHL, will he go back and play in Russia next year? That's why he fell all the way to 31. He's a top 10 talent, I'm telling you.
What I like about him is, listen, there's two ways to get to the inside. You can be quick and you can pass it there, or you can drive through to the middle. This guy, he's going to bulldoze his way in there, and he has the skill set to finish things off once he gets there. So this is a power forward that has size and a desire to get to the net. That's what I saw when I watched him, and this is a good pick.
He was the first overall selection in the CHL import draft last year. His dad was a Super League goaltender in Russia, and asked Klim, okay, when were you able to be on par with your dad? And he said, around 6 or 7. And when I scored on my dad, there he is. When I scored on dad when I was 7, dad retired.
That was it. He shut her down.
He was done.
That's when you need to go.
Klim Kostin, and they've got the room to themselves back there, and they've earned that. But didn't score a goal in the Super League in Russia, in the KHL, and had won in the minor league. So this is a different pick, a player that could have gone really anywhere. Vegas Golden Knights had 3 picks tonight. They've enjoyed their week with the expansion draft and now the amateur draft. Their assistant general manager, Kelly McCrimmon, former coach of Nolan Patrick, is standing by with Elliot.
All right, Kelly. You guys had a lot of defensemen in the expansion draft, and it looked as if you guys looked at the first 2 picks anyway as, let's get some young forwards and build ourselves up that way.
Well, we came into today unrelated to expansion, but we really wanted to try to add a good center iceman to start our franchise. We're able to, with Cody Glass and Nick Suzuki, followed up with Eric Branstrom, I think, get a real good start with this group of players.
You guys had lots of picks. There were lots of talks. You know, George McPhee did say tonight that you guys looked to do it with something with Vancouver, but you knew Glass would be where you wanted. How close did you come to maybe making a big splash?
Well, I guess you never know. We think we did make a big splash with 3 picks in the top 15. you know, we talk to all the teams, and I think that's common, and yet it's challenging for people to move down. You get excited about the players that might be there, so I certainly respect and understand why none of the picks ahead of us were moved, but obviously we did inquire.
Was this easier or more challenging than being in a fantasy football draft with Darren Millard?
Well, every team has to have a guy that finishes in the bottom, right? Every league?
That's right.
So we had some high-quality candidates on that team, not just Darren Millard, but it was a lot of fun. This is probably easier, to be honest.
And just, Kelly, finally, you've got one more day of the draft. You guys have been planning and preparing and waiting for this for a long time. Has it been everything you expected?
Well, we've worked our way through it, so expansion, you know, was our real strong focus. We're real happy with how that whole process went. We know that the amateur draft is where we're going to build our team, so this is, like for all the teams, the most important day of the year, and really pleased to have had three selections in the first round. Our scouting staff on the amateur side, we've got great experience, great expertise, real hard-working group, and I think that they delivered real well for us tonight.
Thank you, Kelly, and congratulations.
My pleasure, Ellie. Thank you.
All right, Darren?
The director of player personnel for the Vegas Golden Knights, Bob Lowe, is also part of that fantasy league. Kelly's team was the Crim Reapers, and he won it every year. He was the commissioner, and he's right. I was terrible at it, but enjoyed the beaking. First round is complete with 31 picks in the book. The draft continues with rounds 2 through 7 here in Chicago at the United Center. The NHL draft presented by Adidas. 10 a.m. is the start of the coverage on Sportsnet and Sportsnet Now. Chris Johnson, senior NHL writer, Sportsnet.ca, will be part of our coverage. Back to recap the Canadian clubs and their selections as we continue the Friday night in Chicago.